Evening, everybody. This is the Board of Selectmen meeting for Tuesday, March 28, 2017.
Turn my mic.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, liberty, and justice for all.
Thank you. Everybody got mics on? Okay, we did not have an executive session this evening, so go right to public session. Public forum. Is anyone here this evening that would like to address the board, share ideas, thoughts, or opinions regarding their town government? No takers for public forum. Okay, thank you. Item number three, the consent agenda. We have minutes from March 22nd, 2017. We have parade permits. We have a special temporary alcohol license. And we have some gifts. I'll read out the gifts, and then we'll cover who wants to break what out. The gifts are $7,500, which will support the town's tax relief fund for senior citizen residents of Hopkinton. These are all coming from the New England Laborers Training Trust Fund. So $7,500 for the town's tax relief fund, $5,000 for a one-year lease of the police department's motorcycle, and $2,500 for senior transportation, all from the New England Laborers Training Trust Fund. Does anybody have anything they want to break out in the consent agenda?
I break out four.
Four, thank you.
Two, Mr. Chairman.
Two, thank you. Two is parade permits. Anything else? Chair will entertain a motion to approve items one and three of the consent agenda.
So moved.
Second.
Quick comment or thought on item three. Let me just look at something here. Especially temporarily. Wayne Wilson, she's
in prison. Looking for that too.
This is for the Hopkinton Little League, for the adults only at St. John the Evangelist. Okay? Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Items one and three pass unanimously. Okay. Item number two, Mrs. Wright.
Item number two, parade permits. A general comment on parade permits. This past weekend, and I'm quite sure this was a whoopsie kind of a thing, we were very late with the marathon BAA permitting of the training run. And after the training run, I heard from a resident about an excessive amount of trash that was left uptown. And again, I think this is not normal. BAA is one of our closest partners in the town. And fortunately, it was cleaned up very rapidly. I'm not sure whether it was one of the Her clan that did it, but it did get cleaned up. But it raised the issue of trash cleanup with respect to parade permits, particularly with road races, of which we have many, which often are prone to producing trash because runners leave their bottles and their clothing and whatever before the race. I did look at our parade permit application because there's one right in our agenda for the Little League parade, and I noticed that there is nothing that speaks of who will be responsible for cleanup. There is also nothing that asks for a contact phone number for someone on the day of the event who can be reached in case there is any problem. And I was noticing afterwards the liquor license permit that we just approved, that addresses cleanup, and St. John's Parish has very distinct rules about leaving the area clean. So again, I'm not sure with the general parades, like a Little League parade, it tends to happen more in road races. But I think we should effective immediately. I would like to recommend that we add to the parade permit application those two pieces of information. Who will be responsible for cleanup of the area, and a name and contact number as to who can be reached on the day of the event for any reason. I think that you know, when I looked at St. John's, it talks about leaving the facilities clean. When a group uses the environs of Hopkinton, those are the facilities, and they should be left clean as well. So I would like to suggest that we make that change immediately on our application.
Okay. So, Mr. Kamalo, thoughts on changing the application for parade permits? Do you see an issue with that? It seems like a very logical thing to do to me.
Yes, through the chair. In fact, Maria Glynn discussed this issue with us in the office, and we are incorporating those two comments into future applications.
Okay. So, in fact, I would suggest that the current applicant, even though I don't see any issue with the Little League, and I don't think a parade is going to produce trash, but that information of who's a contact person that can be reached on the day of the event should be standard for every permit application, so there's someone to call.
On-site coordinator for any parade permit that we issue.
If anybody complains to the selectman, we can quickly look at the application, see that number, and if one of us gets the complaint, we can call that person. I don't have to call you next time.
I was halfway home from Vermont. Okay. I think it's a great idea. So an on-site contact, please, added to the form. An on-site contact cell phone, please, added to the form. And an understanding that all trash must be picked up by the parade organizers or their participants, however you want to say it, but let's get it.
Okay.
Right? I think it's a great idea.
I think if the cleanliness is stated right in the application, that will make the point that they're expected to leave the area clean.
So let's do this. Let's approve these two separately if we could, because I want to talk about the second one for a minute too. Item 2A on the consent agenda, the chair will entertain a motion to approve the Hopkinton Little League parade permit for their opening day parade, which is always really cool, Sunday, April 23rd at 11 a.m., with the understanding that we'll add a couple of key points of information to the permit request.
So moved.
Permit document.
Second.
We have a motion and a second for the Hopkinton Little League parade permit. Is anyone here from Hopkinton Little League? Hi. How you doing?
Good.
Are you excited for the parade?
Of course.
Excellent.
They're more excited.
Now I'm figuring out who everybody is. That's great. Nice to see you guys. Thanks for coming. We just want to make sure that everybody treats the town with respect, right? So, okay. So with that, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Okay, the parade permit for the Hopkinton Little League is all set. Item B under number two, parade permits, is the Board of Selectmen will consider confirming, and I highlight the word confirming, a parade permit for the Boston Marathon training run held on Saturday, March 24th, 2017.
This is the item that Mrs. Wright was talking about.
This is the item that Mrs. Wright was talking about, but this is also a little bit odd in that we are doing this on Tuesday, March 28th, when it was on 24th.
Well, if I may, I don't want to say this was the item. I really don't want to single them out. It brought it to my attention,
yeah.
But it was really under the whole heading of the parade permits. It got me thinking how we could improve the parade permit application.
Okay.
So I'm not really singling them out.
Understood. Mr. Kamal, can you kind of walk us through what happened on Friday from your perspective specific to this parade permit? Was it Friday?
I'm trying to remember whether it was Thursday or
Thursday
Friday.
Thursday or Friday, right?
Yeah. One of those 2 days. We were advised that the BAA had not submitted an application for this particular event. We worked collaboratively with the police chief and the BAA and got confirmation that they were going to submit and in fact had submitted some of the relevant documents, held discussions with the appropriate officer at the police department. For some reason, that information had not gotten to the selectman's office. Also, as part of the discussion, what we learned was that this practice run has evolved organically over the years. It started as an impromptu event where individuals show up and do their practice runs. And there was no specific involvement by the BAA. However, over the years, the BAA, as a courtesy, it had advised the town through some application of the event. And based on our conversations with the police department as well as with the BAA, we anticipate to have future discussions regarding who actually applies for this event.
Yeah. Tom Grope was here.
Right.
Nice event we had with Captain Switzer, and he was clear that, you know, he was sorry that it happened the way it went down.
Yeah.
And he was concerned that it evolved beyond what they really wanted it to be from their perspective. You got to do these practice runs, I get that. And charities are primarily people who are sending buses out here. Yeah. But he's going to work on this next year to be different.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, so how.
One related question. Right before the run, and there was one of the signs that was here as well, there was a yellow runners in the road sign. They're all over town now. They did have the BAA logo and some others, which led me to believe that, you know, they were part of it. Those signs are still throughout the town, and I know there's a 30-day temporary thing on signs, and this is the time of the year when we do have a lot of signs back, you know, a lot of runners start coming to Hopkinton to just the ambiance, I guess, of running through Hopkinton. So are those signs to remain throughout the town for the next couple weeks? Is there any problem with that? I thought they were associated with the run and they didn't go away.
In fact, those signs are installed as a courtesy, I believe, by the 26.2 Foundation.
Okay.
Purely from their concern for public safety. And over the years, again, this is a practice that has evolved over time. They are now doing this in partnership with the police department.
Okay.
I can report to the board that in past years, we have not had any problems with the removal of the signs after the marathon.
All right.
That's
fine. Thank you.
Okay. So, you know, the confirming piece is a little bit awkward, I think, but it is what it is. So everybody okay? So the chair will entertain a motion to approve the confirmation of the parade permit for Saturday, March 24th for the BAA for the Boston Marathon training run.
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? Okay. Thank you. Bob?
Nope.
Number four.
I'm sorry. Bob, hang out right there, please. We'll be right with you. I'm sorry. Number four in the consent agenda. I went to number four in the agenda. Mr. Tedstone.
So I would like to just kind of not gloss over the fact that we have a company in town, New England Laborers Training Center, that have been here for a long time. And every year they're doing stuff for our police and fire and for our public. So I don't like to gloss over the fact that they just quickly threw $15,000 at us, and I want to make note that they did that, and, you know, every year they do stuff like that. So I just want to make sure that that's noted.
Okay. No, I think it's an excellent point. They've been very generous over the years with all kinds of different things, beyond police cruisers and fire apparatus and what have you. They do all kinds of different things for the town.
They're a great organization.
I went there to watch the fire department do training with a multi-departmental training for cave-ins a couple of years ago.
Okay.
Good thing.
Mr. Tedstone, would you do us a favor and just read out the gifts again for just to make sure everyone's clear on what they're doing?
Sure. So the Board of Selectmen will consider accepting three gifts from the New England Laborers Training Trust Fund in lieu of taxes. $7,500, which will support the town's tax relief fund for senior citizen residents of Hopkinton. $5,000 for a one-year lease of the police department's motorcycle, and $2,500 for senior transportation. Three very good causes for the town that doesn't now fall on the taxpayers.
Great. And it's not the only time of year they do this either.
Nope. All the time.
Okay. Excellent. Thank you. So we have a motion from Mr. Tedstone?
Yes.
Okay.
And a second.
And a second from Mr. Catino. Any further discussion?
Just one comment. Also, those are all really consequential gifts. They're pieces of chunks of significant amount of money to a specific cause that will really, really be felt. Mm-hmm. And it's a good opportunity just to point out that $7,500 to the tax relief fund, that's one of those funds a lot of people don't even know it exists. It often gets overlooked. It's hard to find ways to draw attention to it and raise funds for it. In recent years, it has not been, really hasn't received the amount of support that it should. This really makes a big difference for the senior citizens in helping to allay their tax burden. So I just think it's great that there's that large a contribution to this really important fund. It might alert other people to such an important fund in a really consequential area if you're thinking of making a gift.
Thank you. All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? It's unanimous. All set. Thank you. Good job. Bob, if you could hang on for one sec, please. So, folks, I'm not sure if anyone's here this evening to participate or observe the public hearing focused on the Greyhound Friends here in Hopkinton. Is anyone here for that this evening? Sir, we've postponed that meeting until a future date. So we're not going to be discussing it this evening, but I just want to let everybody know that now so you don't sit here if you don't want to hang out.
Set another date.
We have not set another date yet. We'll do that at some point in the future.
It was just in the paper, right? They just published it, in the paper.
Yeah, so we had correspondence from an attorney on Friday, which led to us postponing the hearing to a future date.
Okay.
Okay? Great, thank you.
Mr. Hare?
Mr. Kamala, sir, hang on one sec, please.
Actually, we do have copies of the memo that the town received from the Greyhound Friends.
Yeah, if you want to share that with him, that'd be great.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Anybody else? Okay, so back to item number four now, which is volunteer recognition update. A few weeks back, or a few meetings back anyway, we talked about how our town is run by volunteers. We are all volunteers. School committees volunteers, Parks and Rec volunteers, lots of volunteers out there in all different capacities. And sometimes maybe we don't recognize them as much as we should. And Bob, who was formerly on the personnel committee here in town, another volunteer, has come up with, I think, a great idea that he would like to present to us this evening, focused on how we can recognize these volunteers with Mr. Kamala and Mrs. Lazarus helping out. Okay? With that, Bob Levinson, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. In the date here on the slides, we were originally going to present this 2 weeks ago. We had a little storm that got in the way. But this just want to give you an overview of what we're talking about. And the idea is to formalize this idea and to do something that's as simple and executable. We can get going right away. A number of people here in town who represent what you were just saying, Mr. Chairman, about the spirit of recognition were involved with this, got their ideas on what would make this successful, a number of advisors as well, and stealing or borrowing from Mr. Kamala a saying that he gave me a while ago, which I really like, and it gets across the spirit that's behind this, that the town does run on volunteers, so how do we recognize them in a formal way? And it's a great opportunity here. It's not a problem. One of the steering group members said that to me. I had first it said problem statement, and I think it was Gene Birchman said it's really an opportunity statement to do something a little bit more frequently, a little bit more formal, but not make it a heavy lift, but recognizing the spirit of volunteerism here. And the goal, this is Mr. Kamala's words again, simple and actionable. It does not have to be something really formal and really bureaucratic. A simple way to do this where people feel like they've been recognized. And, you know, frankly, a couple of committees I was on, we had outside people from outside the town who committed a lot of hours and a lot of time and a lot of expertise, and we said thank you. And it would have been nice to do something simple for them. So that's the spirit behind this. And I won't drain the slide, as we say in industry, but there's a couple of things I wanted to point out that we'd have some criteria, so this just wasn't wholesale passing out certificates, but not make it, as I said, overly bureaucratic. It would be based on significant accomplishments for people who are, as Elaine had said, true volunteers, and they contribute to the quality of life here. It would be open to people in town, and we have out-of-towners who come in and contribute on different committees, and that the nominations would come from people in town. And it would be a very simple nomination process, simple type of form that could be available on the website, and just a couple things in there, why the person is being recognized. It would be sent to either the town manager's office or some type of group that was kind of spearheading this. But the key to this, whoever it is, there needs to be some ownership for it. Someone has to be tasked with doing this, or it's going to be a nice idea that everybody likes, nothing happens with it. And once the whatever mechanism we have for approval, they could be recognized here every 2 weeks or other ways. I think annually the town meeting is a little bit too distant, but quarterly, whatever we can determine what the timing is. I'm not sure if there's any feeling on that whatsoever, but some regular cadence with it, some formality to it. Any questions on this bit or stopping here before we continue? Sample. This is not exactly, it doesn't have to be it, but this took me about 10 minutes to put together. That's the idea here. It does not have to be very elaborate. I offered to go to Walmart and buy these so we can have a supply in town hall, but it doesn't have to be a big deal. But I think we've all seen people who get this type of thing keep them. They have them on the walls, they have them on the desk, whatever. It means something. It means that someone around them said thank you, and that they were recognized literally and figuratively. So that's the idea here, something like that in mind. This, by the way, does not speak to my PowerPoint skills. It points to how easy this type of thing is to do. Yeah, unfortunately, someone once said that no good deed goes unpunished, so what could be the issues here? And we tried to think about it with our little steering group, what could be some potential obstacles and what could be some potential opportunities from that. So what I've seen is whenever anybody's been recognized in, say, a public forum, well, what about so-and-so? What about them? And that happens invariably. But if there's so you have the opportunity, fill out a form. You can do that. Then have a reason for what they did, and it's open to anybody. If we don't have enough nominations, first of all, it's okay, because the goal, as it says, we don't want to have too many of them. We want it to be quality. There's got to be a reason for it. And we can have reminders periodically that the deadline's coming if you want to recognize someone. If too many nominations, first thing is that if a simple form could minimize the number of requests we get, because instead of just saying, well, recognize my husband or wife or someone I know, you have to take a few minutes to fill out the form. And then also, if we get too many, it's what's called a high-class problem. It would be a good thing, I think, if people were recognized.
I may have missed this, Bob, but while you're there, if we get too many, who then makes that decision?
That's under the TBD category, Mr. Chairman, because the mechanisms of this, our steering committee just proposed some mechanisms, having it either go through Mr. Kamalo's office or have a separate group that's tasked with it so they can make those final determinations. But again, there should be some type of accountability. Someone should be, a volunteer should be in charge of volunteer recognition, or someone from some town hall, just so it's, again, there's a regular cadence to it.
Okay.
So as I said, to be determined would be the frequency, determining who else in town is doing this type of thing so there's not overlap, so it's consistent. And finally, we're looking just for you to say, yes, proceed, and we can work out the details there and getting that level of ownership. But that's the idea here.
So this is volunteers in town government, correct? So not volunteers in the baseball organization, which is a great organization, or there's incredible volunteers in lacrosse, and there's volunteers in soccer, and there's volunteers at the arts center. I mean, this is volunteers in town government. Is that what you're talking about?
The way I believe we thought was volunteers in town. And as I said in the first slide, anybody who contributes to the quality of life here, that could be through
so inside and outside of town hall or other town government type organizations.
And even within town government, we have people who are paid and people who are on payroll, they wouldn't be considered the true volunteers, but
right.
We have a number of committees. Even, you know, the first slide, as I said, the people put in a tremendous amount of time here would be people like that.
Yeah, I'm fine with that. My first thought was, okay, this is a town government thing, but he's suggesting that his committee or his group is saying it's beyond that. So just an FYI.
Yeah, well, I guess I would have a question with that, too. I noticed you mentioned this isn't to compete with other, you know, other groups and other organizations, and I just wonder, particularly with youth sports, where there's such a big program and so many volunteers, you know, if some of these organizations already have their own awards or recognition mechanism. You know, I just wonder if maybe we should start with town government, because you just open up youth sports and you could have the thing swamped, you know, during baseball season or soccer season, and all of a sudden it just becomes an extension of the athletic program. And, you know, if those groups already have this, the idea behind this, I think, is because there's a lot of unsung heroes that give a lot of time to town. So maybe it would be good to rethink narrowing down the field for the start, so that it doesn't become just another adjunct of another group that already does recognition. I don't know.
Okay. Are you all set, Bob, in terms of your thoughts and presenting?
This reflects our little steering committee there with a few people, and yeah, I think it gets what we're looking for across.
Any other feedback from the board?
I do. So in my short time that I've spent in town government, almost a year now, the steering group, Pam, Jean, Bob, and Dottie, you guys are on every single thing I think that come across here. So I think it's awesome that you're recognizing this, but you should be the first four people. Like, seriously.
Do we nominate ourselves? Is that allowed here?
For the stuff that you guys do, that most don't see, whether it's an email, you know, if something's not going great, you might get an email from one of these people saying, hey, don't get down, you're doing your best job, or working through these things. It's so nice to have people in general, but more specifically, these four people on the steering group are if I were to think of nominate the first four people, these are the first four people that I would nominate. So I think it's a great thing, and I also know that these four people that are on the steering group probably don't want the recognition for it. They just do it because they like to do it, and they
I want it. They don't. They're
So that's you know, that's just some of the stuff that it's nice to where I've come on to as a selectman. I've come out of some of the circles that I normally ran in, and now I'm in some other circles. It's nice to see some of these four people that are prevalent be in charge of now this recognition program. So you know this recognition program is going to be done right moving forward. So thanks a lot, and I think it's a great program. I'm all for it.
Thank you. Bob, before I put my glasses on, I saw volunteer recognition up there, Bob Levinson. So you come up, when you came up, I just thought we were giving you an award. Oh. I really did. It was just one of those.
Feel free.
Just so, this is great. We're running Bob, but that's great.
It's actually a $500 gift certificate to Colellis.
I'll frame it somewhere. Thank you. I was actually, I tell you, a couple things motivated me. Like I mentioned, that a couple committees where I think we had an opportunity to recognize people, we didn't. But when I was watching the Charter Commission, that thinking about the unbelievable amount of time they put in, all for us to come up and say why we disagreed with them at special town meeting, and also with Dottie Ferrer Wallace, who I'm honored to be there with, and I've seen her for years at the Marathon Committee, and talk about unsung heroes. Yeah. And Dottie doesn't want it. She's going to be mad at me right now for mentioning her name. But you know, that we have a lot of people like that in town, and it's a great opportunity. And you have all kinds of. It's a great opportunity for you to just say thank you to them. So I think it's
well, good. Well, I'm sorry. So the same thing when I'm on that elementary school building committee. There's all these people that are in there, but Pam runs the whole show. Like she's got it all in her head, and it's amazing to me to sit here and watch her do her thing, and all for free. You know, like it's great, and it makes it. You guys are making Hopkinton great again.
Okay. With that, we're gonna move on. This is right.
Well, I was just gonna say it's not on the agenda listed as an action item, but I see your last bullet on your presentation says tonight's ask BOS approval to proceed. Certainly, I for one think it's a great idea and would love to see you proceed.
I would love to see it proceed. I like the idea of starting with town government first and seeing how that goes for a while, because I think we have lots of committees and lots of people, the ones you mentioned and many, many others, there's dozens of them, that over the years haven't been recognized, and maybe they don't want to, but they still should be. So I think we could start there, or at least that would be my feedback anyway, is one, and then see how it develops over time. But I think if we could focus on town government or, you know, all the different agencies, and there's probably 100 committees out there, right, that have volunteers on them, I think we'd have plenty of opportunity to recognize people. And then maybe someday evolve beyond that to town stuff. But I think a lot of town stuff already happens.
Exactly.
So that would be my feedback, which kind of matches Mrs. Wright's. Anybody, everybody else okay with that?
I'm good with that, yep.
You okay with that?
Yeah, it makes sense. Just get your thoughts on mechanism for it. Does it make sense that there's a couple people designated to do this? Does it make sense to go to Mr. Kamala's office? What do you think? Because I just said, I don't care who, just as long as someone is tasked with this and owns it.
Mr. Kamala, what are your thoughts on sort of all we're chatting about here?
I think first off, I want to take this opportunity to commend Bob for the passion, the professionalism, and commitment to making sure that we cross the finish line in terms of this project. I also share Bob's observations in terms of why we came to this point where we're recommending this this steering group and process. So specifically, just to share with the board, the idea of not narrowing this exercise to town government was to simply get started. We really want to get this started. We don't want to be hamstrung by, well, if we can't find a town government volunteer, then we don't do anything. So I hear the board's feedback, but I think we should leave it open so that at least we get started. This process is evolving organically. And that's why, even at this point, Bob, I think town hall working with the steering group should continue to be the focal point because it has worked that way. I don't see that limiting the project going
forward.
When
you say town hall, you say yourself and Mrs. Lazarus?
Yes.
Okay.
The town manager's office and the steering group.
Okay.
Continue to be the focus point.
So, I'm not clear, Mr. Kamala. Are you saying that we should not start with focusing on town government and open it to everyone, or what we were saying of keeping athletics and all out right now and just focusing on I wasn't sure which side you're coming down on.
My suggestion is that to get this going, let's keep it open. It's a concept that is evolving organically. Let's see what happens. If our experience is that we need to limit this, then we can come back to the board and share that experience. And also in terms of the structure, I think we should continue the partnership between town hall and the steering group being the focal point. Administratively, yes, information can be sent to town hall as the receiving point, but I think in terms of the mechanisms as to how this works, I think it should continue to be a partnership between the town manager's office and the steering group.
Okay.
If I may, I would just play devil's advocate for a minute to advocate for starting small and expanding rather than going the other way. If we were to open it up and find that we had a flurry of, soccer coaches and Little League and et cetera, it's always harder to take something away than it is to expand it, to turn around and then say, nope, we don't want to recognize you guys anywhere, we just wanted to be town government, as opposed to if you started with the town government and then you decided to expand it, that just sounds great. I'm just looking down the road from a planning standpoint of, it can be a negative or it can be a positive, depending on which direction you take it, is my thought.
Yeah.
But that's just me.
Yeah.
So, Bob, and your committee is saying leave it open. Your group, your team is all supporting kind of keeping it open, right?
That was the initial recommendation. We haven't spoken since then. It does make sense to me, but I would ask what their opinion is.
So how about if we do this? Everybody is behind us recognizing the volunteers in town government and across the community. There's no question there, and I think we're all behind it 110%. There's a little discussion about maybe how we start and where we start. So, you know, we don't have to do it tomorrow. This isn't a budget discussion. We don't have some deadlines on it. There's some feedback. Great idea. We love it. Kick that around with your team, and then let's chat again. Right?
Good.
Is that a fair way to go forward? Everybody okay? We don't need a formal vote here tonight. I think it's all good, and let's keep it going. But with that input, and Mr. Kamal, we hear what you're saying. You're hearing what we're saying, and you know, talk to Bob and his team, and then we'll go from there.
Okay. I like. I don't know what your thought is, but when you present those certificates, if I think Brian, you were the one that said something about quarterly, it might be nice to do it. To give people the option to come up here and have it be presented to them from us monthly or quarterly or something like that, not just get something in the mail or come pick it up at the town hall. I know some people probably won't come up and do it, the people that don't want the recognition, but like a chance
the glare of the lights.
Yeah, I guess it puts on a couple of pounds.
I think you're right. I think that added touch, the personal touch, makes
absolutely sense. And that's what we are missing, and that's where we saw in a couple of cases that we didn't recognize people, and we should. Okay, everybody good?
Good.
Bob, thank you very much. Great effort. Great help for the town, and looking forward to it.
Great. Thank you for helping getting this across the starting line.
Thank you. Okay, that's item number four on the agenda. Item number five was going to be the public hearing for Greyhound Friends, and I don't believe we have any folks here for that now. I think some others may have arrived and departed, but that will be at a future date. Liaison reports and board invites. Mr. Kamalo, Mrs. Lazarus, on board invites first. Anything come in recently?
A legislative breakfast? Did you get an email this week regarding a legislative breakfast this Friday morning in Medway?
Mm-hmm. MMA. Mm-hmm.
I don't recall seeing that.
Northwest.
MMA.
Is anybody going to that by chance?
No, MAPC. Excuse me.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I'm not.
Okay.
Talking about it.
I don't recall seeing it. I had a lot of emails this week. That wasn't one of them that I remember anyway. Okay, so there's that. Anything else? All right. Liaison reports. Mr. Tedstone.
I don't have any.
Nope. Mr. Catino.
Well, Friday, we all went to Catherine Switch, who wasn't liaison. But
Mr. Catino is now the liaison to Catherine Switzer.
No. But this is one thing. No,
Go ahead.
But there was just something, another thing. Boy, I go to a lot of things for the time.
It was really cool.
But as people know, Catherine Switzer came by, and this is one of her books. She's got a second one coming out also. And she sent signed books to board. There's one for everybody.
Well,
so
nice.
I don't know if
that's cool.
Wow. And
you'll notice the first thing I did was turn to the back and make sure it was less than $50, so we can accept
excellent.
That.
Excellent.
Excellent. She wrote a lot to you.
Oh, that's yours, Norma.
And Claire.
Oh, thank you.
There you go.
Awesome.
Yeah, it was just,
that's great. That was
she was such an inspiring speaker. It was just wonderful to hear. I wish I could have brought my daughter, but luckily it got, it was recorded and for posterity, and a lot of people can watch it now. Just a very inspiring speaker. Wonderful.
It was a really cool event. We had this room was full of people. They had lunch, and Catherine Switzer, who was the first woman to ever run the Boston Marathon officially from start to finish. She had a little tiff along the way because the people were trying to take her out of the race, but she got through that, and she went on and finished the race. And so that was 50 years ago. And so, I mean, not that age matters in life, right? But so she's got to be, I don't know, 70, 72, something like that.
She was 20.
And she's an incredibly fit person and full of energy. It's amazing. It's amazing. So good for her. That'll be an interesting thing to watch as part of this year's marathon.
And she's running.
She's running the marathon this year. Good for her.
We joked about, after we watched the photo, I said, you know, behind every great woman is a real strong man. That her boyfriend, the one that smoked the the marathon director that tried to pull her out of the way.
Yeah.
What would have happened without that guy's presence?
That's right. Okay, anything else, Mr. Catino?
That's it for me.
Thank you. Mrs. Wright?
I don't have any new liaison reports, but just a couple other marathon-related things. April 13th, the Kenyan runners come to Elmwood School, so I know I will be attending that. I don't know if anyone else would. There's a 2.62-mile walk run up at the middle school, which is, I can't remember what the cause is, but then it's also a marathon-related thing that was postponed from last week, so that's a nice event. And I just also wanted to mention, I was so inspired by Catherine Switzer that the Historical Society has a very lovely marathon ornament that they put out that can be engraved for runners, and so I have ordered one as a gift to Catherine from the town and the Historical Society that we will have engraved on for her 50-year anniversary with her KV Switzer, which was her registration and her number and the date she ran and her approximate time. So we'll have to make arrangements to get that to her. I thought it was a nice thing to do. From historical, the motto that the Historical Society has with it is keep history, make history, and she certainly made history. Yep. So
great.
That'll be coming.
Excellent. Mr. Camallo, could you update us on the recent talks you've had with the MWRTA executive director specific to transportation? I think we're making some progress there. We haven't had a meeting recently, but I know there's been some action in between.
Yes. Brian and I, as well as Cindy and Amy from the Senior Center, have been in conversations with the MWRTA in terms of expanding their services in the community. In this case, we're responding specifically to an increased need for transportation by individuals who need to be moved from point to point rather than simply getting a bus along the Main Street bus route. So this will be a point to point transportation service. We have received a positive response from the MWRTA indicating that they are willing to move forward in partnering with the town in providing the service so long as we can confirm our specific need. We have. We're now speaking internally, meaning and the senior center staff, the town manager's office, as well as Mr. Hare, in defining what our need is going to be. The good news is, overall, there is commitment to expanding the transportation service in town, and this particular initiative will focus on providing transportation from point to point.
And our need is growing in the community too, and that's documented and it's numerical in their analysis. As we grow as a community, and we're growing fast and furious, as we all know, the need is increasing, so we'll get some more services to go with it. Mrs. Wright.
Can I just ask Mr. Camallo, I remember the Senior Center telling me that there was a specific need, not for just general transport, but specifically for the handicapped accessible transport. Are there plans that service will be included? Because I thought the seniors had really limited van capabilities, and that's where a lot of the requests were coming from.
Yes, that will be part of the service provided. Okay. Specifically, we're looking for the dial-a-ride service, and that dial-a-ride service will provide our services for handicapped, elderly.
Okay, good.
It's on an as-needed basis.
Right, but it will include the handicapped van.
Not a route.
No.
Yeah, okay. Okay, thank you, Mr. Camallo. I have no other liaison reports, and we're covered invites. Everybody all set? Mr. Camallo, town manager's report, beginning with FY18 budget update.
Yes, through the chair, the Appropriations Committee is continuing its budget review. This week, they met with the Land Use Department, the Library, and the Senior Center, and they are inching towards the public hearing process. At this point, there is no substantive information or feedback to the town manager's office and the Board of Selectmen, substantive in the sense of requiring an adjustment to the budget that was moved forward to the Appropriations Committee by the Board of Selectmen.
So they haven't found a few hundred K kind of sitting on the side somewhere that we can address quickly?
Not at this point.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
And then...
Hang on one sec, please. So are you going to move off budget?
Yes, I'm going to move off budget.
Let me go around the table here, though, real quick. Mr. Catino, any thoughts, any questions about where we are with budget to date?
Well, I want to see it lower, but other than that, I guess I'm okay.
Okay for now?
Yep.
Mr. Tedstone?
Same thing. If we determine that we have to cut a certain amount of money, it would be nice to find it. It's going to be... I think it's going to be hard to convince some of these departments that they don't need all the money they're asking for. So ideally, like you said, there's a all of a sudden they come across a $545,000 typo that we had too much in the budget, but this is the part of being a selectman that I don't particularly love, to be honest with you, is trying to cut everything, but it's something that we're going to have to do.
Okay. For now, you're good?
Now I'm good.
This is right.
Yeah, I mean, I don't see anything has changed from the last time we had this discussion, so I think we're right where we left off.
Okay. Does the Appropriations Committee have any thoughts they want to share about where they are, or are they all set?
I don't want to speak on behalf of the Appropriation Committee.
Okay.
Since we
didn't discuss this. Okay. All right, thank you. Mr. Kamal.
The draft 2017 annual town meeting warrant. We included a copy of the draft warrant in your board meeting packet. And tonight, thanks to the efforts of town staff as well as, specifically Elaine Lazarus and Town Council's office, we have an updated version of the town meeting warrant, still in draft form, in front of you.
Mr. Kamal, could you do me a favor, please? Because I even get confused after all these years. Can you define what the draft warrant is?
Yeah. The draft warrant is the notice given to the public relative to the items that will be discussed at town meeting. It's in article form, which therefore means we identify the subject, the sponsor, and it then becomes the basis of developing the motions. Most people are now familiar with the motions document. That is the document that is shared with the public at town meeting. It includes the article language that is contained in the warrant, the motion that is moved, and the required vote, and the recommendations by different town entities. So this is the first stage towards getting to the motions document that will be shared at town meeting.
Okay, so I think the key word in all of that is draft, right?
At this point, yes, it's still in draft form.
Right, still in draft form. So nothing has been etched in stone, and there are no motions typed up specific to these article placeholders.
Correct.
That's coming.
Yes, in fact, the board is required to sign the warrant by a particular date, and we will be asking the board to sign the warrant at your next meeting, which will be April 11th.
When we sign the warrant, we sign the warrant, not the draft warrant.
Correct. Why we call it draft now is this gives us the opportunity to circulate it to all the stakeholders, get their feedback, and then we'll finalize it prior to the next scheduled Board of Selectmen meeting for signature.
Okay.
At that time, when the warrant is set, it is therefore set in stone.
Got it.
Yes.
Okay. Any questions about the draft warrant? Not the articles yet, but just the draft warrant, the concept. Mr. Catino.
I just wanted to ask, when were the cutoff dates for warrant articles and for questions to be on the ballot? I believe we passed both of them, haven't we?
Yeah, we're going to cover that when we get to the articles.
I just figured that was more of a general question.
Yeah. Go ahead, Mr. Kamal.
To the draft.
Yeah, we can answer those questions. The warrant opened, I believe, first week in January, and it closed March 1st. What that means is, statutorily, that was the time for different proponents, petitioners, proposing boards to submit their requested articles to the town manager's office. And thus, the deadline was March 1st.
For both articles as well as ballot questions?
I'm coming to the ballot questions.
Okay.
That was just for the articles.
Okay.
The ballot questions derive from the warrant articles. And thus, the articles that are provided to the town manager's office by March 1st become the basis of identifying the ballot questions. And the ballot questions usually arise out of the budget process, where the town says, through funding source X, and based on the need to involve the whole town in deciding the funding for that particular project, this item will be placed on a ballot question. Some of the ballot questions also derive from state law, where state law specifically requires a ballot question to be set for that particular item.
Okay.
And the deadline for setting and this has to be stated clearly, the deadline for the selectmen to set the ballot questions and forward them to the town clerk's office is April 10th. April 10th, 10.
April 10th is the last day to set the questions to the town clerk.
Yes.
Okay. All right.
Only the Board of Selectmen can set the ballot questions.
Got it. Anything else, Mr. Catino?
That's it. Thank you.
Good. Mrs. Wright.
So, our next meeting is April 11th. Yes. That's also the date that we set it in stone. So, is tonight our opportunity to go through the warrant, not take positions, but go through the warrant and give input if there are questions or any issues that we see right now with the draft articles?
That is correct. In addition, this is the moment for the board to indicate to us who you might want to invite to your meeting April 11th for the final discussion of the articles, not the motions.
Right.
The articles.
I have several.
Okay.
List.
So everybody clear on what a draft warrant is and a couple of the dates to set things up to arrive to where we are now. Everybody good with that? I just wanted to kind of do a review because it gets confusing. Okay, Mr. Kamal, how would you like to proceed?
Some information that might be helpful as the board walks through the list of the articles. In terms of the end game, number one, the board will need to sign the final warrant as we just discussed. Number two, the board will now need to start thinking about its recommendations relative to specific articles. And in that regard, I just want to share with the board the following framework. In terms of the board recommendations, the board may be required to make a recommendation to town meeting by law. So when we present the motions, after the board has signed the warrant, bear that in mind, that the board, we will indicate specific articles that the board will absolutely be required to make recommendations because the law requires them to do so. Number two, the board is also required by the town charter to vote on the budget. Board already did that. May adjust its vote based on the conversations with the town manager, the CFO, the Appropriations Committee, the School Committee, and other town departments. The board may also be required to recommend and make motions on specific articles that are proposed by the town manager. The town manager is not a registered voter in town and therefore cannot make a motion. Thus, if the board is going to make a motion on a particular article, it's highly advisable that the board at least makes a recommendation on that article. And then
if the town, if the town manager is going to make a recommendation for an article, he wants us to take a position.
Because he can't.
He,
not
right?
Risen.
You said the town, if the board's going to make a recommendation for an article, the board, it's you meant to say the town manager.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, he can't. He doesn't live here.
Got it.
Yeah.
Okay.
And then there's also the perspective that the selectman is the chief executive board of the town. And therefore, our recommendation to staff is that the board should take positions on any articles that have policy implications.
Got it.
Yeah. And then finally, there are articles that are funded through water and sewer rates. Since the board is responsible for setting the water and sewer rates, we highly recommend the board to take positions and make recommendations on those articles. So I believe, Brian, that lays out the framework and that the board should now start thinking about going forward. So specifically, now we're going to go through the warrant. I'm suggesting, Brian, that we go through the warrant page by page. We'll simply call out a page, and if the board has any questions on any particular article on that page, then we'll take it up.
So what I want to nail down is, because we don't have article numbers here,
right?
Because it's still in flux, right? It's draft, so it's still in flux, and it can move around a little bit, and we can move things a little bit. But what I want to nail down is the type of questions that tonight's discussion would be appropriate to ask. In other words, if there's a typo in here, do you want us pointing out typos? Do you want us, and conversely, or other extreme, if you will, if we don't like this article, do you want us to make our point now? I don't support this article. To what extent do you want us giving you input right now?
Yes, it's typos. It's articles that fall within the purview of the board's authority. I.e., for example, we are proposing proposing changes to the kennel bylaw. And we'll be asking the selectmen to sponsor that jointly with the town manager. So we want to know today whether the selectmen will...
Right, but particular to the warrant review, we're not going to stop there and debate that for half an hour because that's a separate item on the agenda. Okay, so when we get to that, we're going to skip it quickly and go to the next thing because that's coming up soon here.
Exactly.
Okay, so the goal here, as I understand it, and I'm going to make sure everyone's agreeing with this, we're not going to debate every article in front of us tonight, okay? If there's one that's going to really get you going, just note it because we're going to come back to it next week, and that's the one where you're probably going to want to hear from the article sponsor as to what this article is all about because you're not there yet.
Next week or next meeting?
Next meeting, sorry. Okay, so everybody understand? Let's try this, and then if we have to stop and sort of reset, we will. So I'm going to walk us through it as quickly as I can. And then you just let me know if you want to stop. Acceptance of town reports. Hopkinton Day. And I'm not reading them directly because I'm hitting the article name. So if you guys can look and if anything's jumping out at you, please let me know. FY's 2017 supplemental appropriations. FY 2017 budget transfers. Unpaid bills from previous fiscal years. Mr. Kamal, in all three of these articles, do you see a lot of action here, or is it pretty benign?
At this point, I see them as pretty benign, except though on a lighter note, I think we should have a new title for the last article, the unpaid bills. We may call them the Mrs. Claire Wright bills.
Mrs. Claire Wright bills, okay.
I think we all remember her comments at the, was it two town meetings ago? Yeah.
I got done, didn't
so,
I?
Everybody good? Okay.
Yeah.
Property tax exemption increase. That means we would increase the property tax exemption for certain classes of real estate. Set the salary of elected officials. Mr. Kamal, Mrs. Lazarus, I'm sure you guys are going to jump into if something is of concern, correct?
Yep. Yeah.
Fiscal 2018 operating budget. We know there's going to be lots of discussion about that. So obviously, when we get to the warrant article on the budget, we're going to want to have the input of the Appropriations Committee, and we'll want to see if we can't have some further dialogue with our friends at the school committee, right? So everybody good with that for now? 2018 revolving funds. Chapter 90 highway funds. Your DPW director will bring that up at town meeting.
Through you, Mr. Chair.
I really want him to get a t-shirt. Transfer to general stabilization fund. Mr. Kamalo, I'm assuming that'll be part of the budget process, really, right?
Correct.
Okay. Yeah. And I haven't seen anything yet where we really wouldn't weigh in. Right?
At this point, yeah.
Transfer to capital expense stabilization fund. More budget discussion stuff. OPEB, other post-employment benefits.
Nothing like OPEB.
Okay. Senior tax relief. Means-tested senior property tax exemption. Mr. Kamal, is that a new one for this year?
Yeah, this is a new one, and in fact, it was inspired. I'm trying to remember the name of the resident who stood up at town meeting and asked that the selectmen and town hall consider exempting seniors from specific large-scale capital projects. This is our attempt to address that issue.
Everybody got that? I think this is a really interesting article, and I think one that can help a lot sort of balance out what's going on, right? Okay. And that kind of rambles on the page six there. So we're jumping over now to page seven. I'm on cemetery funds transfer. Everybody good? This is right? Mm-hmm. Hopkinton Day funds.
Again,
why wouldn't that be tied to the Hopkinton Day?
I think 2 points. One is the structure of the warrant, where we have resolutions, financial items, zoning bylaws,
okay,
capital projects, and so forth. That's why at this point they're separated. However, I'm sure when we move towards town meeting and have discussions with the town moderator, the decision may be to perhaps take this side by side. However, as I explained before to the board, if we find funding in the FY17 budget for this process, we'll reserve some monies for that, contingent on the resolution passing a town meeting.
Okay, everybody good? I think the tag, the suggested budget number was 30 G's, is that right?
Yep.
Okay, so. This is right.
Ooh.
We have a couple young men in the back there if they'd like a Easter egg, or they're welcome to join us here. You all set? Okay. All right, so moving along, Hopkinton Day funds, everybody good? Sewer flow metering program. Okay. Underride. Mr. Kamalo, please explain.
Yes, this is in fact going to be a two-part process. We have an article in town meeting, not required by law, but I think based on past practice, the board previously felt that the town meeting should vote on the underwrite. This will be followed up by a bylaw question. Last time when the board discussed this issue, there was a number thrown out, 1.5 million. We're coming back to the board to confirm that that's actually the number.
Okay, so Mr. Kamalo, this says it's a non-binding resolution because an underwrite has to go to the ballot, override has to go to the ballot, and there's no action necessary really at town meeting.
Yeah.
Correct?
No action required at town meeting, but again, as I said, previously the board felt that a vote at
town meeting. Shed some light on it, and you can go from there.
Yeah.
Anybody okay with this underwrite?
Brian, your mic.
Everybody okay with the underwrite? Okay.
And Mr. Head, since we are on that topic, the board needs to get ready when we discuss the ballot questions to discuss the amount of the underwrite.
I thought we already discussed the amount of the underwrite. I thought it was 1.5.
Yes, the number was discussed, but when I went back to the video, unfortunately the video didn't cover the whole discussion. So I just simply wanted to come back to the board and confirm that the number is 1.5.
Okay. That's fine. Okay, article on page 8, pay-as-you-go capital expenses. We've got lots of different things on here, and I think there'll be some more discussion about this as we move forward in the budget cycle. But the concept of this is where it's going to show up at town meeting as an article. Everybody good with that? And again, we'll be adjusting maybe some of the things that are on there. Everybody good? For now?
What's some of these taken off? When we discuss that, like some of these next articles coming up, weren't they removed?
Perfect. You're correct. In fact, we were going to point this out. The next two articles, town hall generator controls and the fire station boiler, these were taken out with the understanding that we are looking for funding in the FY17 budget.
Okay, so we're scratching town hall generator and controls. That will not be in the final warrant article or final warrant of, correct?
Correct.
Okay. And the fire station boiler will not be in the final warrant.
Correct. There's a clarification. The fire station boiler will be replaced by the fire station HVAC and roof. That's the project that we had discussed, okay. And we just realized this afternoon that that project was not included in the warrant.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, one more time.
The board already approved the ballot question for that project.
For the fire station roof and HVAC?
Correct.
And we didn't have it in here?
Yes.
Do we have a timing issue with not having it in here?
No.
It was submitted. It's redundant, right?
Yeah. It was submitted on time. It's just that when town council crafted this version of the warrant, that project was missed.
Okay, so basically fire station boiler comes out, fire station roof and HVAC goes in.
Yes.
Yeah.
And there's a ballot question we already set up for that.
Question on the,
five. Yeah.
Okay. Everybody good? And we're good with page 8, right? I know we've got things over here that are still in flux, yes. But everyone's good for right now. I just didn't want to skip over that too fast. Page 9 again, Main Street Cemetery fence repairs.
Just a process question for Mr. Kamal. An article can be pulled right up to the evening of town meeting, correct?
Correct.
Okay. Yeah. Because, I'll just give you a heads up on this one. We certainly don't need to fund it twice. This is also in the CPC funds, and the commission put it in on the outside chance that sometimes town council looks over the various CPC projects and finds a problem with one of them. There was a concern that the repairs might be deemed maintenance that CPC would not allow. So this was sort of an insurance if we couldn't use the CPC funds, but I'm assuming that by the time town meeting comes, we will know what's been approved on that list for CPC funding, and if it is still there, we can just pull this after that.
Okay.
So, but we can do that even the evening of, correct?
That is correct.
Okay.
Yep.
Yep.
Okay, so everybody good?
Mm-hmm. Good.
Yes.
Repurposing of appropriated funds from annual town meeting 2016.
Typo? Can I just email you the typo?
Yes, please.
Oh, it's just at the very end. For the of conversion of water treatment. I think it's for the conversion. Got the of.
Yes. Thank you. Mr. Hare, this is funding that was approved in 2016 for use by the DPW. And based on our most recent water studies, they want to convert that appropriation to the water treatment project at wells number 4 and 5.
Okay.
Yeah.
Too many eggs. Everybody okay with that? So basically, we didn't spend some money that was appropriated in 16 that we're going to reap a portion and send somewhere else.
Mm-hmm. Yes, and in fact,
sorry.
Yeah, initially we thought that might not be required, this conversion may not require town meeting vote. However, we were specifically advised by Bond Council that we are required to go back to town meeting and restate the purpose.
I think this is the first time in my years that I've seen a reappropriation of an article from the prior year. Just an FYI.
Yeah.
Right? We don't do this very often.
Yeah.
Okay. Fruit Street blending facility construction.
needed.
What is it?
I assume it has something to do with the wastewater treatment plant.
No, it's Mr. Kamala, let's talk about that one.
What's that?
Maybe Mr. Kamala should speak to it because I don't want it to give anybody. Well, what I know about it is that we have one well that is in high in some
manganese.
So it's on the water.
And then
pumps.
One that isn't, and so just it's to bring the two of them together so that we can come up with good water.
All right.
So it's Fruit Street water well work.
Yep.
Got it.
I thought it was like putting shrubs and stuff up.
I thought it was a blender.
Ninja.
Everybody good? At least for the tonight's discussion? Okay. I think we're doing really good here. Hayden Road traffic calming.
Good to have.
Okay. Hayden Row area sidewalks. Mr. Kamalo, are the sidewalks, are these sidewalks separate from the sidewalks that we said we'd hold off on?
Yes, these are separate, and they are intended to support the new school.
Were these at one point included in the sidewalks that we decided not to handle this year?
I thought that they were. I thought there was, it was this, West Main, Wild Road, and...
Chestnut Street, Wild Road.
I know I received some feedback from the community after we had that vote saying... Hello, we're building a new school and you don't want a sidewalk? I'm like, you know, so I didn't get into it. But
yeah, well, there's two different ways to look at that, too. These kindergarten kids aren't going to be walking down the sidewalk by themselves.
Yeah.
And when the parents come get them, they can park at EMC Park and go get them if they need. So
how did this come to be here now if we're not doing sidewalks as general this year? We'll take a year off of sidewalks.
Yes, Mr. Chair, with your permission, we'll invite Mr. Westerling to come before the board and explain this.
So that's a good one we want. So far, that's a great point. So far, it's the first one that jumps out at me that we need to understand what's going on with this article.
And I seem to recall...
Including budget.
We kept the Hayden Row sidewalks. The one we pulled out was the Chestnut Street Wild Road strip.
I didn't think that we could pull out one.
I didn't think we had any individual strips of sidewalk. I thought we were talking about sidewalks, period.
I don't remember saying it.
The discussion was $1.5 million for sidewalks.
$1.7 million, yeah.
Whatever.
Yeah.
For sidewalks, right?
Yeah.
And now we have a couple of specific
articles,
so I'm a little confused. So, but just to reset where we are for a minute, what I've seen so far through page 10 is we obviously want to chat with our friends at the school committee, appropriations committee about budget stuff and articles, and now we want to talk to the DPW director about sidewalks. Mm-hmm. Is there anything else that we've seen so far that we need somebody to come in and explain what the article's about? Everybody good?
Yep.
Okay. So far we don't have too many visitors, Mr. Kamal. Okay, so let's table both sidewalk discussions, but there's some question there, right?
Okay.
DPW salt shed.
Just to be clear, Mr. Hay, the Chestnut Street sidewalk is a citizen petition.
Okay, so that's a different deal.
Yeah.
Was that submitted and all that stuff lined up?
Yes, I believe the town clerk did verify the signatures.
Mr. Town Clerk?
They have 10 verified signatures.
Okay, so that sidewalk article is outside our purview.
Okay.
Okay, but the first one is inside our purview with our team. Okay? So we would like to talk to Mr. Westerling about Hayden Row sidewalks, but we don't necessarily need to do anything. If the citizen wants to come in at public forum and say hello, they're welcome to it, but we can't. We can't require that, correct? We can't.
We cannot require them, but I think we should encourage them so that at least they can use this platform to educate the public. However, I think your point to the board is the board has no ability to remove a citizen petition from the warrant.
Right. So just so we're clear, we can't say no, right? Okay. All right. So DPW salt shed. Everybody okay? I thought he was going to hold off on that a year. Am I wrong?
No, I thought there was some other thing that he found, some boulders.
Yeah.
That's why they had to do it.
And that's what I thought this... he's coming in, so I think we want to chat about that, too.
Yeah, I want to chat about that. I don't understand how you can run a have such a big construction site and do their test borings and things like that, and all of a sudden come across a boulder field and not know that it was there. So
yeah.
Discuss that with him.
Okay. Application of bond premiums. I have no idea what that is.
Yeah. In fact, this is taking advantage of the new municipal modernization law, and the finance director is proposing that we bring this to town meeting.
Okay, everybody good? Mm-hmm. Middle school auditorium HVAC upgrades. Isn't that on pay-as-you-go, no?
It's not in pay-as-you-go.
I thought so.
Elmwood, Bill.
Hopkins HVAC.
That's Hopkins HVAC, okay. All right, that's by the school committee.
Correct.
It is what it is, good. Elmwood School Solution. Mr. Kamal.
The selectmen already voted to authorize the school superintendent to submit the SOI. Mm-hmm.
Which the chair has signed, FYI.
Yeah. And also, as part of the budget discussions, the town manager's recommended budget, as well as the conversations with the selectmen, included $600,000 for the feasibility study for the Elmwood School SOI.
Everybody good?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Community preservation funds. We're moving into CPC now. So now we're into an area where CPC sponsors the article, puts it on the warrant. The selectmen don't necessarily have a legal responsibility to vote yay or nay, or even to weigh in certain town meetings. We've been asked for our opinion, and other town meetings we've been asked to keep our opinion to ourselves. So you never know kind of how it's going to go, but let's go through these. So there's the first, it's a report of the Community Preservation Committee, which is all good. And wait a minute. So they're putting it all into one article, Mr. Kamal.
Yes, and that's how town meeting has looked at it. If you so wish, we can walk through A through M. Again, this is still being reviewed by town council. Town council has offered some comments to the CPC, and there may or may not be changes to the list.
Okay, so let me just talk about the logistics of this. We have A article for 15 items, whatever, of tens of thousands, if not hundreds of thousands of dollars from the CPC fund that sits separate to our general tax funds for community preservation work in one article.
But usually people can pull it out.
Yeah, exactly. That's how we've always done it. It's one article, and people can pull it out, similar to what the board does with the consent agenda.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'd like to note that on Article J, when EMC Park was being built, there was a person that wanted to donate the lights to EMC Park, and the town turned him down, 100% out of his pocket. And here we are 10, 12 years later, now we need $250,000 for that.
Okay.
So sometimes the cutting your nose off to spite your face is...
Well, the idea of turning lights on over there in general, I think it would cause some...
It was a 10-year moratorium that was a deal arranged with the neighbors that they couldn't light it. So, you know, I don't know if the offer is still good, but
it's not.
I think that's why we are where we are.
Okay, everybody clear as to this particular article? Okay. Zoning bylaw amendments. Moratorium on marijuana establishments. That's by the planning board. I'm assuming that is a significant policy question, and I think it's one that we should plan on voting yay or nay on. Okay? Everybody okay with that?
Mm-hmm.
We don't have to do it tonight, but...
Yeah, this was just just like the other law. We needed time, though the planning board needed time to actually look into it, because now the it hasn't been defined yet as far as the state goes.
Okay. All right. Gross floor area site plan review, the planning board. These articles we will not be asked to weigh in on. Flexible community development bylaw, planning board. Open space and landscape preservation development, planning board. Restaurant definition and parking requirements. I always remember Mrs. Lazarus going on the microphone and getting into these articles in great detail. I was always amazed that she could find all this information in these 10-page articles.
She was at every meeting, drafting them.
Hotel parking requirement, planning board. Utility structures, planning board. Does that have anything to do with some of the utility requests going on in town these days?
Yes.
Okay. Sign bylaw, again. How many times do we do the sign bylaw?
Every year.
This is right.
I know this is planning board, but somewhere we need to ask them for clarification because it seems there's a contradiction. L says no portion of any wall sign shall be above the first story of a building. But then it says, in addition, there may be one wall sign at the top of the building, which seems to contradict no sign above the first story.
It's in a separate section of the bylaw.
Section L.
Two separate sections.
Yeah, I see. But if it's saying there may be one at the top and the other thing says you can't have anything above the first story, don't those kind of contradict each other? If it can't be above the first story, how can it be at the top if it's a two-story building?
In the Industrial A and Industrial B district, there would be an exception made, where in those districts, the thought was there could be one perhaps facing the highway up the top of a building.
Well,
so, Mrs. Lazarus, we have a question on that one, right? Mrs. Wright, I'm sure we'll follow up. Okay, so there's the question there, but I think...
Chief of the planning board.
There was something the planning board added.
Okay. General bylaw amendments. Departmental revolving funds. Mr. Kamalo.
Yes, you will notice that there are two articles regarding revolving funds. The first article simply would not change the approval of revolving funds from how the town has done this in past years. This new article, in fact, takes advantage of the municipal modernization law and would allow the town to actually pass a bylaw that we will then use in future years to establish revolving funds.
Who is the sponsor of this article?
Town manager.
So the Board of Selectmen will have to weigh in.
Yes.
Everybody good for now?
I have one, just one question for Mr. Kamalo. Article 6, revolving funds under A. Is this redundant? It says, fringe benefits of full-time employees whose salaries and wages are paid from the fund shall also be paid from the fund. Am I missing something or does that not make sense? If they're paid from the fund, they shall be paid from the fund.
Yeah, we'll take a look at that language.
Okay.
Thank you.
What page was that, please?
19? 19. Right there. Paid from the fund, paid from the fund. Okay.
Question two. Got it. All right, so that takes us through page 23, posting of warrant. Selectmen, I'm assuming this is coming out of maybe some charter review discussion and just general administrative efficiency.
Yes, and also input from the town clerk.
Town clerk. Thank you, yes. Mr. Town clerk. Everybody good? Minutes of public bodies. Mrs. Wright.
Yeah, both this one and the nuisance bylaw, it said it was Board of Selectmen, and I know I have missed a couple meetings. I just don't know where this came from, and I seem to recall this one we tabled discussion because the meeting was running late, but we apparently this board is putting these up, and I don't know that we've had opportunity to even discuss them.
Mr. Kamal.
Yes, I believe the prior discussion was the board authorizing town staff to place these articles on the town meeting warrant with the understanding that when we get to this point and the board begins its discussions of the different articles, that the board will take its position and let us know whether we recommend taking no action or taking action.
So would this, but by the time we meet on April 11th, the thing is set in stone, would this be the point to the time, since it's one of our articles, to, you know, discuss whether some changes should be made in here? Because I know the minutes, I you know, have some feelings on some of this language that I think should be modified.
Mr. Kamal.
Yeah, if there are specific pointers that the board members would like to draw our attention to, I think this is the time to do so.
Mrs. Wright.
My concern is with the minutes of meetings. I know we want minutes to be posted promptly, and you know there have been boards whose minutes didn't get up for months and months, but we also need to recognize that by and large, many of our town boards are filled by volunteers. They don't all have you know, town staff. And I have sat on boards where it's not, for whatever reason, a volunteer can't necessarily get the minutes by the next meeting. If they, you know, are ill and they miss a meeting or whatever, I just think that this 14 days is quite a high bar for volunteers, that, you know, to perhaps double that to 30 days to allow, if the secretary who's taking the minutes had personal issue or couldn't be at that meeting, it still allows the minutes to be filed in a timely manner, but I think it's a bit overly demanding of town volunteers. So I would like to see a little more time given.
Any suggestion on time?
I think where it says here, B, all minutes no later than 14 days after the meeting, I think all of them should be granted 30 days rather than 14.
Mr. Kamal, Mr. Town Clerk?
Yeah. The suggestion is well taken. However, I think I need to verify this with Town Council. I believe this may be required by law.
Mm.
Yeah.
Okay. Town Council.
Yeah.
Court.
Town Clerk.
But the most of the requirements set for when minutes have to be approved are set by open meeting law.
Mm-hmm.
I know one of the suggestions I had originally pushed with the language was to make it so after it was accepted.
Yeah.
So 14 days after acceptance, because at that point it's already written up. It's been accepted by the board, and then it can be handed in and published where everyone can see it. And this primarily came from an issue of where many town boards, committees, groups, otherwise, they're the only true, necessary, and legally required custodian. It makes filling public records requests in particular extremely difficult when, like you said, I have 10 days to fill a request and I handle all the general requests. So if I'm having to chase down a volunteer board that might not be able to get to me, or they can't seem to find the file, or I've had instances where it's been lost or they haven't submitted minutes for 2 years.
That's not good. So may I ask, not submitting minutes for 2 years is different than needing an extra couple of weeks or whatever. Are you saying that we don't have much flexibility in extending this at all? I'm just looking for mercy here.
So, and I would need to refer to Mr. Kamalo and Town Council about my suggestion of it being following acceptance of minutes.
Yeah.
Because I feel like that would give a bit more flexibility.
Sure.
As I said, though, some of the requirements set for when minutes are accepted are already set by the open meeting law. And so it's not necessarily something that we would be able to have much control over.
So if you say filing by acceptance of minutes, would that still leave the door open for them not to file the minutes for months and months? I mean, I don't have a problem with setting some guidelines for when they have to actually get the minutes done. I just think 2 weeks is kind of short.
So if I may, the concern isn't necessarily that if it's to get them after the minutes are accepted and they're all set, to make it so that they put them in a place that's easily accessible to the public.
Right.
And that can be my office, but also as much as the town website, just for government transparency.
Mm-hmm.
The other thing that we run into there is they're not necessarily required to hand their minutes to me. This would give some sort of codified law saying, or bylaw saying, the minutes have to go to the town clerk and then be conspicuous and accessible. So it's more so just trying to make it so that once the minutes are done, then they have to be given to the town clerk's office so that they can be easily accessible to the populace.
So if I just may clarify, Mr. Chairman, through you, it sounds like the objective of this is not to encourage or push boards to get their minutes done. The main issue is getting them filed with the town clerk. Okay, because, I mean, I don't have a problem with trying to encourage boards to do their minutes. I mean, I don't think it's acceptable when a board leaves minutes hanging out there for 6 or 8 months.
So outside the time frame.
Yeah.
Is there anything else in there that
draws
concern?
No, it was the time frame of a board. I think once they've got them approved, it shouldn't be a problem to get them filed. It's the issue of reasonable time for a board to get them drawn up.
Is it possible between now and the time that we go from draft to final warrant that we could codify around what an acceptable time frame would be for you as well as town council and the town manager and Mrs. Wright?
Yes, we'll work with town council. And just to be clear, the language as proposed already references a copy of approved open session minutes. So these are already approved.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And also in terms of timeline, they're saying within either 14 days after the second meeting following the meeting to which the minutes relate.
Relate.
Yes. So it's 14 days after, let's say if the meeting was today, it's 14 days after today, provided that less than 30 days separate such meetings. So that's pretty wide. Yeah. And then within 14 days after the first meeting following the meeting to which the minutes relate. So again, just wanted to clarify that this is not 14 days after the meeting is held.
Okay. But I'm just trying to understand how we would adjust what we have in front of us tonight before the 11th, because this becomes etched on the 10th, correct?
Yes. We will have a conversation with town council to see if these times can be extended per the suggestions.
And somebody will circle back with Mrs. Wright?
Okay.
Yes.
Yeah, we can.
Will that be you or the town clerk?
I'll do so. We'll work with Mrs. Wright and town council.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you good?
Yep.
Mr. Catino or Mr. Tedstone, thoughts on the timelines?
Yeah, that's right.
Okay. All right. Okay. So we'll move ahead then. Discharges to storm drain system. Director of Public Works. This has got state law written all over it. Okay. Mr. Tedstone, you're okay with the timelines being adjusted in the minutes discussion? Okay. So I'm up to page 29 now, driveway standards.
Okay.
By the fire chief. Driveway standards, chief, driveway standards for whom? Is it just taking out that senior housing piece?
No.
It goes into the next page.
Got it. Okay, so you want to fire? You want to approve all driveways? Does that include residential?
New buildings.
Yes, it's one and two family homes. Right now, there's no coverage at all.
I'm surprised the planning board doesn't address that.
Yeah.
Well, if I may, Mr. Chairman,
sure.
It came through the planning board, but it was decided it should be a general bylaw as opposed to I believe that's what they thought, as opposed to a planning board bylaw, because it takes effect with all new building that's going to happen.
You good with that?
There's an existing driveway bylaw to which this would be an amendment.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And the general side?
Yes.
Yes.
Got it. Everybody good?
I know that when I went through my personal subdivision, there were many hoops to jump through for driveways and driveway permits and imaginary boxes that fit on land. And so,
I remember
but
your...
But I don't recall that the fire department had to go through that.
I think I was on the planning board when you guys were doing your...
Yep. Thing.
Mr. Chairman, if I could have a second.
You don't have to lean in. The town manager's the only one that does that. We don't want to hurt your back over there.
So the discovery is the current bylaw, and just kind of point of education, it was for me, for the driveway, covers the public way of a driveway, the first 6 feet in most cases. There is nothing covering a driveway. And that's there was a Massachusetts regulations that kicked in 2015, which gave me the authority to cover driveways, and it was a very strict regulation, and it was very broad and really impacted everybody, and it was stopped and undone for one and two family houses about 5 months ago. So just the learning curve was we have nothing that covers our driveways, and I do run into issues where the way a driveway is constructed that I have houses that I cannot access with my equipment. So I'm just trying to get at that in any form that I can. So that's gotcha. Kind of the gist of it.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Everybody good?
Mm-hmm.
Yep. Gotta love logic. Nuisance bylaw.
This is right.
Where did this come from?
Was yeah, I think that's a fair question. No,
because
it's a fair
this
question.
Thing is fraught.
Where to start?
This is fraught with... Let's, so much overreach.
Let's get the background first. Where did it come from, please?
Well, I guess I can answer that one. This came through the Zoning Advisory Committee bringing a change to the planning board. But looking at it, the planning board thought that it should be more of a general bylaw as opposed to a zoning bylaw because of some of the things that were incorporated in it.
Mr. Kamalo, background on this article, please.
I think over the last
perhaps
3 or 4 years, there have been issues that have come to the Board of Selectmen's attention, either through the enforcement departments or through the board's review of specific licenses in town. In addition, there have been calls to or emails to the Board of Selectmen and the Town Manager's Office from residents complaining about nuisance, blight, unsightly conditions in their neighborhood. It could be on somebody else's property or on somebody's property that is now abandoned. And as we worked through those complaints, it became clear that there were opportunities for the town to address this issue. So specifically, we are responding to complaints from neighbors regarding the conditions or storage of unsightly materials by their neighbors. We are also responding to feedback that we received during licensing instances, where specifically our town departments identified some issues that needed to be dealt with on some properties. And I believe that's where this is coming from. There was a discussion at the planning board to pass a zoning bylaw that would address this issue. Through the planning board discussions, the issue was then referred to the general bylaw, and that's why we brought it to this board for consideration.
Mrs. Lazarus, your thoughts on this?
The same. The Zoning Advisory Committee reviewed both the zoning option and a general bylaw option to have both available for both boards to consider.
As the chair, I've spent a fair bit of time specific to this very issue, not on the bylaw, but on residents and the concerns residents have across the community about other property within, you know, view of their property and complaints about real estate values and all kinds of other things. So I don't know if this is the perfect solution, but the idea of being respectful of property rights of yours and the property rights of your neighbors is something that it's a fairly common, I think, discussion in a free society where we have landowners, but I think it's something that has to be discussed.
Well, if I may, I guess 2 points. First of all, just procedurally, I feel like if there's an article that turns out that it's now going to be sponsored by the Board of Selectmen and has our name on it, I'm bothered by the fact that it comes to us this late in the process. The next meeting, it's set in stone. I would like the board to have more time to discuss in depth something that we're putting our name on. And secondly, I just feel that this is so... so much government overreach, very, very overbearing. There's so much of this that is very subjective. It seems to be fraught with opportunities for this to turn into neighborhood disputes as to what do you consider dilapidated, what do you consider blighted. There are references to something as simple as a building that needs paint, a vehicle that is rusted and worn. Doesn't say it's got to be a dead car. Well, maybe your neighbor isn't in as good a financial position as you are, and his truck has some rust on it. And no, I don't like it, but this just smacks of such elitism. And I can remember an issue just a couple years ago that came to this board and also came to the planning board, a dispute. It was couched as a roadway dispute, but the underlying issue was a neighbor dispute, and they were using, there were clearly town laws that they were using to as a vehicle for their neighbor dispute. There are things here about lumber on your property unless it's under a building permit. I mean, we had a tree that came down years ago, and we had the lumber milled, beautiful hickory wood, and we've used it for various building projects, building furniture. We've had bricks that we use around the yard that are piled in one corner. If you're going to start picking out what people keep on their private property, I just have a huge problem with this, and I just think it's going to open the door for a lot of subjective decisions that come down to one neighbor wanting to make an issue with another neighbor. But I am sorry to see this come at this late date where we can't have more input as to what is reasonable and what is overreach of private property rights. So I have a real problem with this one.
Okay. Anybody else have any thoughts?
Well, so for this, there's a lot of common sense that I think that has gone away with a lot of issues around. And a burn structure that's no good, I'm good with having that get removed. But like Claire said, you know, if someone had an axe to grind with you and said, you know, Claire's pile of bricks at the corner of her garage, that they're, you know, hopefully at some point going to put a walkway in, it lends itself to all the subjectiveness that can, kind of lead to neighborhood disputes and neighborly disputes. I guess it's that there's nothing black and white as far as what they consider dangerous or unsafe? Like, who determines that? Is it Chucky Cadlick or the building inspector, or is it you know, us, the Board of Selectmen, or is it, you know, whomever? Like, it's hard to determine what's dangerous or unsafe or overgrown vegetation. What I may think is a weed patch might be a beautiful bunch of raspberry prickers or something like that that you make jam out of once a year. You know, I'm all for it. I think that, I mean, when I say I'm all for it, there are people out there that let their stuff go and go and go until it collapses, and then it just sits there. And, you know, the neighborly thing to do is to go over and talk to them and say, you're going to get rid of that. It's really an eyesore. But sometimes it's not really, you know, you're not really welcomed with open arms when you go to deal with those people. So it's nice to have an avenue to go to, but it's hard to say who's going to govern this, I guess.
I just want to add to that, I've seen some situations in this town that pertain to seniors that were on a limited income and really didn't have the resources to maybe keep their home up quite the way you or I would. And this kind of thing really worries me, how it might affect some of our citizens. We are a well-to-do community. That doesn't mean that everybody is in that situation.
That said, if we do determine that this bylaw is to be governed by the building, by Chuck
Cadlick.
Actually,
it's in there. It's,
okay, so I, like, wholeheartedly, with all my heart, trust Chucky Cadlick and, you know, the people historically that have been our building inspectors to say, you know, if I called and said, you know, the Claire's hickory tree that's overgrown on our driveway is really bothering me, and I call the tree warden or whomever it is, and they come up and say, well, I'm sorry it bothers you, but it doesn't rise to the level of it being removed. As long as there's someone that's a rational thinker that can go to one of these other facilities, one of these other houses or properties and say, no, that's not actually, you know, you may think that it's no good, but it is still good.
I would have less trouble if the determining factor were safety, but it seems to me there's a lot of aesthetics in here about blight or worn or dilapidated. Lot of room for subjectivity.
Mr. Kamal, can you speak to the timing of it a little bit, please? Just sort of how it sort of came to be at this hour, if you will.
Yes.
Is it because it went through Zach and Zach went to the planning board and the planning board said it should be general and that's why it came here this quickly?
Exactly. The fact that it went through the normal process, back then the thinking was that the planning board was going to be moving this forward.
What were the votes at Zach on this? Do you know?
I can look it up. Give me a minute.
Actually, it went through Zach. I believe it was unanimous.
Okay. How about planning board? Or they didn't take it up?
Planning board didn't take it up, but planning board thought it would be better as a general bylaw.
Okay. So.
And it was, you know, if I may, it was crafted by using. Excerpts from several other neighboring towns, and using some of the portions of their bylaws that seem to work for them, you know, and you know, there's nothing to say that we can't you know, craft some of the stuff out of it. But as Brendan was saying, you know, there are some just basic parts of it that I really do think can work. You know, pull out some of the subjectivity because, you know, there were things that just, you know, anybody would say, my goodness, that's just not right.
I think there's a basic thought that's probably okay, but as you said, there are parts of it, but I think there are a lot of parts that are, you know, overbearing.
Mrs. Lazarus.
So this was a unanimous vote at SAC to forward this along, and it is based on Upton's bylaw, which is nearly identical that it passed last year.
And it passes state constitution and all those sorts of criteria. Yeah. Chief.
I just put my eyes on this for the first time, but a lot of what's in here, the building inspector and I are responsible for in some form under some state statute and public safety law. So I just want to just kind of pass that piece along. A lot of it, I know I already have responsibility to kind of report to you, and it's a challenge to implement state law, whether it's buildings, dilapidation, fire, some forms of hazard. So it's my first time skimming through it. I just wanted to give you that feel that there's a lot of conditions here I've had to work through before, and maybe we haven't addressed them before, but it is regulation, and we are responsible to act on it in some form.
And I'm sure that's the case, but I can think of one example, and I'm not going to get into names or addresses or anything, where I'm just amazed, and I think it's a raging safety area, and I think it's a raging eyesore for the neighbors, and it's in a neighborhood area of town, and it is absolutely impacting the financial viability of properties to its east, north, south, south, and west.
And there's...
And every time I've had discussions with personnel specific to this in various departments in town, there's really nothing we can do because we don't have a bylaw for it. Yeah. So you're saying you and the inspector have a lot you can do with this, but all I hear from residents is things aren't changing or getting worse, and every time we go and walk and do different things and try to facilitate discussion and solutions, I don't get very far.
Yeah, and I think my point would be there's, I'm just learning there's probably a lot of tool capability that allows us to work at something easier than me turning to some of the state regulators to help. Yeah, and there are quite a few issues that I am currently working with the building inspector that may be not in your forefront right now, but this may be a tool. I apologize, I just haven't kind of adapted to this yet.
I'm glad you gave us the feedback. So how about this? I mean, again, we don't have to vote it tonight. We're talking about what we're thinking about it. I think there's some mixed reviews on it at the board level. I think you have specific concerns and things you'd like to see strike from it. Could it be something we could look at over the next week or two collectively and strike some stuff, and we can come back on the 11th and with a new modified version, see if it's something we'd want to support? What I'd like to do personally, it goes back to common sense, and it goes back to common decency and respect. Okay. And there are obvious examples in town where people don't care what other people think looking at their property, and frankly, they're disrespectful. And this should address that going forward.
As well as a safety concern.
And safety concerns. But a stack of bricks that you're going to put in your garden, you know, my neighbor's been working on doing his sidewalk, and he's got some bricks, and he's doing some things. That's all I do. I mean, we all do that. So that should be in here.
I just worry about a senior who can't afford.
And those types of things where we're nitpicking and there's a little paint chipping on the trim, that shouldn't be in here. But the common decency or the extreme examples, we should be able to walk in and say, the bylaw does not allow this madness that you have right here.
Right.
That's what I think this should address. So if
tightening.
Right. So we need to figure that out. So would you mind trying to tackle that with them?
Sure.
And then we can all look at that. Does that make sense? Everybody good?
Yep.
Okay.
Thanks.
That's 21, 22, 20, I'm sorry, 33, 34, kennels. We're going to table kennels for right now. There's an article here. It's got a bunch of information in it. We're going to come back to that. As we discussed earlier, I'm on page 38, town meeting quorum. Pretty self-explanatory. We can discuss and vote it. I think we should. That's a citizen's petition. Never mind. Early voting, citizen's petition. Never mind. Not never mind. Those are perfectly valid articles that we'll look at town meeting. Alcohol sales at town facilities, sponsored Board of Selectmen. This doesn't prohibit it, but it tightens it up and makes it very clear what can and can't happen, correct?
Yes, specifically, it would not allow alcohol sale on school property.
Yeah.
It specifically identifies non-profit organizations should be hosting the event, that the net proceeds from the event should benefit community Hopkinton, and that these only be allowed to mark special occasions. It can't be DPW building is going to be holding a function every weekend.
So,
and then finally, we are asking the board that perhaps the board identifies hours for hours when alcohol could be saved.
Okay. Why is this outside the alcohol policy that we've adopted for the town?
Because currently there's a town bylaw that prohibits any sale of alcohol on town property.
Got it. So this is kind of giving some flexibility, but not schools at all. Yeah. Okay.
So how does this impact the cultural arts?
It wouldn't, because it's a not school facility.
Yes, as
school grounds.
We concluded that it's a separate parcel. It's not on school property, and also it is leased. I think that was the conclusion by town council that at this point it's not under the control of the town.
There's a spelling error in this one up top there. Marijuana.
Yeah.
That's the Spanish
term. Can I just ask, how does the alcohol sale at the farmers market on the common across the street from Center School fit into that?
That one is allowed by special, by state law.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And we cover it in the stuff that we passed for January.
Okay. Non-payment of taxes. Page 40.
Yes.
Public consumption of.
Sorry, Mr. Hare.
I'm sorry.
Before we leave, there's a specific question where we are asking the board if you have any suggestions in terms of the hours that alcohol could be served.
I think the hours should go back to the hours specific to the policy in general.
Okay.
Right? We want to try and be as consistent as possible. Mm-hmm. Okay, we ready to move on?
Yes.
Public consumption of, is this THC? Is this... What is this? This is all related to marijuana. Okay. Land acquisitions and dispositions, gift of land. I think that's good. Gift of land. Street acceptances. These are all planning board. Why is planning board jumping around? Don't they usually kind of have all their articles flow at one time? We've done planning board earlier. Now we're doing them again.
Yeah. Street acceptances usually are under the end. Land acquisitions and dispositions.
Okay. Yeah. Street acceptances, good. Easement, 125 East Main, DPW. Fruit Street property leased to youth organization. Okay. Fruit Street property leased to animal shelter. This is right.
Just a question on both of those. I guess I understand you can't, you know, say this is going to be for the Boy Scouts. But then I saw this to a winner of a competitive bid selection. So, like on the land that we've kind of in earmarked for Scouts because they can't use the Pratt Farm, I guess does that mean that a whole bunch of other entities could come in and if they offer a better deal, we're suddenly required to lease the Fruit Street land to them and leave the Scouts out? I mean...
It depends on how you write the RFP.
Exactly.
Yeah. Is
you have to have green uniforms, scarves.
You can make a very specific RFP that the Scouts will be.
Exactly. Yeah, I think it's the language that is used in the RFP.
And that is for the Scouts, this particular article, correct?
Correct.
So it can be crafted to pretty much...
Perfectly legal.
Make sure.
Yep.
Now, through the chair, did we do a similar article last year or the year before for the Scouts for the Pratt property? Will that be released?
Yeah, that was different. In case of the portion of the Pratt farm that was assigned to the Scouts, that requirement was predetermined by the seller and was included in the deed. Yes.
That was part of the deal to sell the land to the town, is that there would be a certain parcel set aside or a certain amount set aside for a Scout lodge. Now that didn't come to be.
So does that, if I'm sorry, through the chair, so does that tie our hands with what we can do with the Pratt property that we bought? So before we give something else to the Scouts, we have to make sure that we have full use of that land back again in case we want to do something else there. That's tying up two properties.
Mr. Kamal. Yes.
Correct. Good observation. I am sure when we get to that point, we will ask that this specific interest earmarked for the scouts on the platform, on the former farm, be released. Yes, that will be part of the conversation.
And we can do that, and that can be pull that deed restriction off.
Yes, I have discussed this concept with town council.
Okay, next article is the article specific to lease to animal shelter. Everybody okay with that? Same basic concept. Mr. Catino, you've got the next two articles, please. I am recusing myself.
Aha. It has the word, that word in there. Okay, the pilot agreement with the Mass Solar Highway Phase 1B LLC. Mr. Kamalo?
Yes, for the board's information, the agreement is currently being drafted. We'll make that available when the board considers the motion for this article. Similarly with the pilot agreement for the NRG Marathon LLC on East Main Street.
Okay. Any questions, Ms. Wright? No. Brendan?
No. The question I have is a procedural one on us recusing each other, I mean ourselves. Is the fact that one of us works in the solar industry, does that mean that anytime something solar comes up, he has to recuse himself? Or you work in the facilities industry, and if any facilities industry thing comes up, or I'm in the medical field, and do we have to?
I don't like personal preference.
Because I trust Mr. Herr's opinions on a lot of these things, and if he's not specifically doing this for his business, then I like him to be able to put his two cents in. But if he feels uncomfortable doing so, then
it's just public if I may speak for Mr. Herr, I think it's just his public perception of wanting to keep everything clean and on the up and up, even though it would be great to have his opinion on some of these things.
I mean, he's squeaky clean when it comes to this stuff, and anytime that the word solar gets noted, mentioned, he doesn't run now, but he three-legged races himself out of the room. But I guess I would think that if something were to come up on in a medical issue, do I have to limp out of the room too?
No, only if you don't do anything private anyway. So
how do you know?
Okay,
I don't know what I do.
Okay, we're good. All right, now speed limits. Page 43, Mr. Chairman.
Page 43. Set local speed limits 25 miles per hour.
Where is this? Is this
page
in general?
43. General. Right.
This isn't that Hayden Row from Milford to the high
no,
school.
No, this was it? The... Oh, I'm sorry, Mr.
This would be kind of all over town. We could go to 25 if we wanted. Mm-hmm. Thickly settled. Love that Massachusetts expression. When I first moved here, I'm like, what are they talking about?
Yeah, specifically, this is on any roadway inside a thickly settled area or the business district or any way that is not a state highway without further authorization from Mass DOT.
May I ask, does that just specify 25, or could you do 30, or is this just allowing for 25?
Allows to go down.
Allows us to go down to 25.
Suppose it was at 40 and we wanted to drop it to 30. Would this allow it? Or is 25 now the new?
It's already posted, so we can't drop. Oh, sorry, Mr. Kamala. Sorry.
Yes.
I was just doing this.
Yes, Mr. Cortino is correct. If the roadway is already regulated and posted, the speed limit having been established through a study,
right,
we will have to go through that study.
That's what they were talking about at that elementary school.
Exactly.
Where they do the studies, and if it's 80% of, if the average speed is 80% of the posted speed limit, then they don't allow you to change it, or the numbers are off, but that's what they were speaking at the elementary school, right?
Yes.
But you're saying that this doesn't specifically address, this isn't just for that elementary school stretch. This could be any road in
any
town.
Any roadway, yes.
So I still don't understand. If it was a road in town that had a different posted speed limit, say 40, and we felt we would like to drop it down to 30, I understand you have to go through the studies, but does it give us the flexibility to vary the speed limit anywhere down to 25?
No, this is the unposted roads. Right now, I believe unposted roads, we can it's 35 miles an hour, I believe, is the accepted speed on any unposted, thickly settled road.
I didn't realize
it. Is 35, and this would change it to
25.
Okay, I didn't realize 35 was the catch-all for unposted. Yeah. Okay.
Set local speed limits, designated safety zones. Now we're getting into school stuff. 20 miles per hour.
Yes. If the town declares a certain area a safety zone, the town could post the speed limit down to 20 miles per hour.
Okay. Anything else? Constables going from appointed instead of elected.
Yes.
Going to appointed instead of elected. I'm assuming this is coming out of some charter review work, too.
No, that's
kind of.
It was that in state, I believe.
Okay. Anybody have any thoughts on that? Life insurance.
Yes. This is coming through based on requests that we have received from most of the town's retirees that we consider increasing the basic life insurance provided by the town to its employees from $5,000 to $10,000.
It's a non-binding resolution.
Yep.
Why isn't that up front?
It got into this category because of how it was established. Okay. It was established through a town bylaw.
Okay.
Yeah.
And finally, trustees of the school trust fund in the town of Hopkinton, see if the town chooses members to fill the vacancies now existing in the Board of Trustees of School Fund. I don't even know what that is, so that's new to me.
Is that new fund, or has it been under the school department and so we never knew about it?
No, it has always been there. I think the concern that we've had over the years is that why does this have to go to town meeting when all other appointments are done by local boards? State law requires that town meeting approve the appointments.
So may I ask, who administers this? This isn't one of the trust funds that's usually under the commissioners of the trust fund. I've never seen this before. Is this administered by the school department? It's not one of the usual trust funds.
Yeah, I'll have to check. But it's been in place for many years because we always go to town meeting with this appointment.
And who is the sponsor of that?
Trustees of the school fund.
So whoever they are.
I mean, all our other trust funds come under the commissioners of the trust fund, and they manage all the trusts.
You want to see if they'll come in?
I'm kind of curious as to where they came.
See if they're interested in coming by for that meeting on the 11th.
I hope they are members.
Yeah, I don't know if we have any, so now we're going to find out what this thing does.
Yeah.
And I just have one more typo.
Yes.
My name on the last page.
Oh, yeah.
That's not me.
Yeah.
Okay.
Sorry.
Okay. All right, so we're going back to page 34 now, kennels. And that goes through 38. Mr. Kamal, what is the background on why this article is on the warrant?
This article is on the town meeting warrant based on our most recent experiences regarding kennels in town, where we identified opportunities to strengthen the bylaw. We also received additional educational materials as well as best practice procedures shared with the town by other entities that manage kennels. We also spoke with our colleagues and partners at the state level, looked at bylaws that were recommended as good model bylaws in other surrounding towns. And the board had its preliminary review of the bylaw at its last meeting. There were specific questions and recommendations made by the board. And with your permission, Mr. Chair, I would like to walk the board through those changes that we made based on the comments shared by the board previously.
So did the animal control officer participate in the deliberations leading to this article in front of us tonight?
Yes.
Who else?
We also received feedback from other kennels in town. We also have received feedback from the state. I believe we've covered everybody. Anybody else in there? Yeah. We've also shared the bylaw with town council. Specifically, we have asked town council to comment on the progressive penalty format that we've suggested in the revisions, in one of the revisions that I included in the in your packet.
And how about the building inspector? Building inspector?
No, we have not consulted the building inspector.
Would we need him? I mean, he was kind of in on the recent review of things, wasn't he?
We can refer to him.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think it would make sense to have him ready maybe to speak to it.
Yeah.
Okay, and then so when you went out to the community and you went out to the and I apologize, I'm just trying to get some background here for all of us. When you went out to the other entities in town that operate kennels, what was the feedback you received? Do they support what you have, what we have here?
Yes, and they also offered us good suggestions in terms of how to improve the language. Specifically, they also confirmed the comment that I think we had received from Mrs. Wright regarding specifying that the treatment is veterinary treatment. Yeah.
And would any of this action taken by town meeting complicate matters that are currently before the town and the state?
I don't believe so. The application of the bylaw will be forward-looking. It won't be retroactive.
Sorry?
The application of the bylaw will be forward-looking. It will not be retroactive.
Okay. So, in effect, anything that might be before the community and the state today is based on those regulations in place today, and then anything that should this pass going forward would follow these regulations going forward, but you can't mix the two.
Correct.
Everybody got it? Okay. So that's my initial sort of background thoughts. This is right.
No, I agreed. I mean, the matter that's before us, we'd have to be judging it on what's in place at the time. We can't be applying something enacted afterwards.
Okay.
So did we... So I'm looking on page 38 on subsection 62.7.D, subsection 1 and 2. Did we create a supplemental or progressive discipline that's different than what was before us before?
Yes. And in fact, the version that is in the warrant is different from the version that is in your packet. The version that is in your packet has the progressive discipline provision.
So.
I'm sorry, that was the email that was online?
Yes, on the iPad.
On the iPad.
Yes, on the iPad. In fact, we can
when
share.
I looked at it today, it didn't. The one I saw today didn't seem to be any different than what we looked at the other night.
It should be in the packet. Here we go.
Has some track changes.
First offense, written warning. Second offense, $50. Third offense, $200. Fourth offense, suspension or revocation.
Claire.
What page is it? On that.
But at this page four on the
four.
Where did we come up with these numbers?
We're offering the numbers for discussion. We've also asked town council if these numbers would pass the thresholds that are set by the law.
And how does this overall bylaw modification, which I'm assuming this is a modification of what we already have, how does this compare to like communities in Massachusetts?
This is going to bring our bylaw to be in line with other communities in Massachusetts.
Okay. That's all right. Does anyone from the kennel community have any thoughts on this proposed bylaw or changes to the bylaw?
I did email Elaine that I thought that these were fair and that we go along with the Association for Shelter Vet guidelines. And actually, we're very fortunate in this state. We have two of the authors of those like nationally recognized guidelines in our state, and they are incredibly accessible. And Tufts also has a shelter medicine program, so there's no challenges in upholding this kind of thing. There's lots of resources, so I think it's fair. I think it's very fair, and okay. I thank you for bringing attention to it.
Okay.
In fact, Mr. Hare, I should mention we also did consult with the town clerk, and he did provide us some input as well.
As far as the licenses and things of that nature?
Yes, specifically with regard to the change requiring that each kennel shall prominently display on an interior wall of the kennel a copy of the license and a maximum number of dogs allowed, if any. Anything else, Elaine?
Above that.
And a maximum number allowed on property?
Yes, and above that, the change that the text shall be inscribed with the number of the kennel license, name of the town of Hopkinton and year of issue. The number of tags issued by the town clerk shall not exceed the number of dogs licensed in the kennel.
Okay, Mrs. Lazarus, did you receive any other feedback from any other businesses or individuals in the community about this?
No. I sent all the 2016 licensees a copy of the proposed bylaw.
You did?
No. They could still contact us, but I have not received anything.
Mrs. Wright.
I had a couple other thoughts, which aren't incorporated in here, but is now the time?
Thoughts that are not here that you would think might want to be in here?
Yeah.
Okay, sure.
Based on some of the concerns that have been raised recently about kennels that are open to the public, where there are areas that are not viewed by the public with perhaps inhumane treatment going on. Is it reasonable on animal shelter type kennels to require that all areas be open and visible to the public, except for perhaps with the exception of quarantine isolation areas? This was one thing that concerned me, that if something is open to the public, there should be no areas where people can't come in and see all the animals that are being cared for.
So let me just, hang on one sec. Let me get your thoughts out. So that's one.
If it's open to the public, it should be open to the public.
Well, there's no back room.
No back rooms. No back kennels, no back rooms.
Got it.
And I also wondered whether there are any, whether it's Humane Society, the U.S. standards, or whatever, any kind of size standard guidelines for what is considered. I know this mentions sit, stand, turn around, although, we've seen indications of animals who, if they're contained for a long time, just being able to sit, stand, turn around really doesn't cut it. Are there any size guidelines that are considered humane that perhaps should be included?
Mr. Kamal.
We continue to struggle with that issue at many levels. there are guidelines that have been put out there. We have tried to see if anybody has set those standards as a regulation. We haven't found that. And then number two, through the conversations with the other parties that are experts at this, we're learning that different dogs require different sizes. Kennel size. And I think that's where we are. I mean, if there are opportunities to further refine this, we will continue to investigate that.
Okay. Anything else? So you had some thoughts about that as a member of the industry?
Yeah, thanks again. I just wanted to comment on the public, open to the public. For us, you guys know how small we are. One of the things, Bill Proctor was in the back kennel with us today, but we have an old kennel, as you know. I'm trying to work on getting out of that, but very narrow space, and it's a quality of life issue. We don't bring people back there. Or we do sometimes, but if there's a lot of dogs in the kennel, it can be stressful for them, and they don't show that well there. So, in the winter, we'll have people come into the lobby, and we'll pull up the dogs, and we'll bring out anyone. They just don't show as well there, but, of course, they can walk to the bathroom and go by the kennel. Nothing's hidden. But we're also the holding facility for the town's animal control, which we don't have a ton of dogs coming through, but we do have dogs that would be on a hold, and that because we're so small, we don't have a place for those. They're in general pup, and so in those cases, we wouldn't want people. We still have the old kennel style where you don't want people putting their fingers in, if we have dogs that we don't even know.
So do you view it as a safety concern?
Sometimes, yeah, for a small place like us. Some of these bigger shelters have different, isolation areas. We don't. So we have one main drag. So if we have shy animals, same thing with the cats. We have certain rooms that we'll take certain people into. But, if a family comes in with a bunch of kids and we have very shy animals or ones that, it's a shelter. There's dogs that, we don't want everyone interacting with.
Does the kennel allow and does the bylaw require that the animal control officer have full access to the facility in all areas? And there's nothing off limits to him or her?
Oh, I would think. Yes.
Is that spelled out in here?
So.
I believe it's in the statute also.
So it's in the state statute that creates. Is that position created by state statute? Okay. So the public, but the animal control officer has full access. How about police? Assume police and fire and safety and all that, right?
Yeah, I don't, that the reason we do it is for the well-being of the animals, not to stress them out with a busy kennel for the more scared dogs. But I don't know if that's right, but you don't want. Bill came down today because we had a cat that bit, and we had a rabies bite hold, and we're keeping that one in a separate room. But these are all cages that you can tell people don't put your finger in. But we're not going to let people in that room until his bite holds up. The general public.
Can I would you allow public if someone said, "Can I just go in and see the dog?"
There's a window on every so they can walk around to the bathroom. But sometimes you have to, if you have, especially in a small cramped place, if you have rabies bite holds, which scratches and bites are not uncommon.
I was just looking for more opportunities for if there's any instances of mistreatment or abuse. More eyes on it. And it doesn't have to come. Maybe the animal control officer doesn't know to come down until somebody reports something. I always worry about back rooms, back kennels. You can't look. You can't go in there. I immediately say, "What's going on?" That I can't see. I'm just looking at it from an animal welfare standpoint of openness.
But also the animal, if I may, by the way I see it also is that it's for the care of the animal also. You don't want people going by, kids jumping up and scaring.
That's what she's
scaring
saying.
The dogs too. It's not like the white, like they used to be, at pet stores with the window with all the puppies jumping.
I was just looking for
a nice checks and balances in shelter, nonprofit world is that you have an army of volunteers. So, we have 120 or 30 volunteers in a week. So, even if we have, it's a nice checks and balances because you have a lot of people coming through there every week. So.
Okay.
Just a thought.
Anything else? Anything else?
I'm good.
Mr. Ted Stone.
So a question I have is back to that 67-7.D, subsection 1. So the first offense, whatever we deem an offense is a written warning. What do we determine a violation? So it's $50 fine per violation for the second offense. If the first time we went there and we said, you know, you're a dog kennel and you have giraffes here. You can't have giraffes here. So we go back there again and there's 50 giraffes there.
That's 50 times 50.
It is. So, and I'm trying to kind of skirt the issue that we have in front of us. Like, if a kennel has permission to have 20 dogs, and we go in and, or someone goes in and says, this kennel had 60 dogs. So they get a written warning for that time. If we go back a month later and there's 65 dogs, is it 45 times 50? Or is it $50 because it's the same violation? Because there has to be punishment, in my eyes, that's severe enough to warrant these people to make the changes.
Yeah, it can measure to the scale of the issue. So, Mr. Cabal, is that in there?
I know there's no specific language to giraffes in there.
It should be per violation per animal or something along those lines.
Each animal is
separate. No, he does have it in there. Yeah. It is in there, $50 per dog beyond the permissible limit.
There you go.
Yeah.
Okay, good.
Yes,
but there's going to be other kinds of violations that you'd want to have it commensurate as well.
And I know that, I mean, that people are already writing emails to this, I'm sure, that I mentioned this, but I just want to know that it's substantial enough that if we find something that there's an issue and we identify it and then we come back and it's the same thing, that it's not something they can snub their nose at. Well, they can. They have every right to snub their nose at, but they're going to be fined or punished appropriately and severely.
Yeah.
Yep. We can always adjust the bylaw the following year. I mean, that's...
I have one more, Mr. Chairman.
So let me make sure he's done, though.
I'm all set, yeah.
All set, then?
Yep.
You good? Mr. Catino.
Yeah, it looks like 62-7... has different numbers than we just went over. I just pointed out to Brendan that here it is each day, $50 per dog if you know for that, and then I just go to the next page and it says fine, $25 per violation, $25 per dog.
We're going by this written one that we have here?
No, I'm just not on the next page. I just what even.
That's the existing bylaw. So that's.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry. Thank you. Okay. All right. Great. It said 324.17 on it, though. That's why. Okay. Confused me.
Okay. Anything else on the kennels?
Yeah. Again, in terms of the numbers, we offered the numbers for discussion purposes, mm-hmm. and we're also checking with town council if these numbers are allowed by law. We just want to make sure we don't exceed what the law authorizes.
I would be surprised if the Board of Selectmen in the town of Hopkinton wouldn't want to enforce the maximum allowable fines by state law in Hopkinton.
Yep.
Right?
I agree, because if the town council comes back and says it's only $25 per violation, then obviously we'll enforce that. But if town council comes back and says, actually, it's $100 per violation, I would like your word, the fact that you just said that we could enforce, that we will enforce the maximum allowable.
So what we have is the draft,
yep.
and they're getting feedback, and they'll take this feedback back, and I think that's definitely something that you should check with town council on, Mr. Kamala, Mrs. Lazarus, and just make sure that we're being as firm, reasonable, but as firm as possible in how we want to have these things managed going forward.
Yeah. And Mr. Chair.
Right.
Great.
Yeah.
One of the issues we also discussed was whether the board has the ability to impose any of the progressive fines at the level that it finds appropriate, depending on the severity of the violation. We shifted away from that thinking because this is a bylaw, we have to be specific. We
I'd rather not have it be subjective. I think it has to be first violation, X, second violation, X and Y, and just keep it straightforward.
Okay.
Because then you get into precedent, all kinds of stuff.
So under subsection 2,
you
same
sound like
thing.
A lawyer over there. Subsection.
So subsection 2, any person or entity maintaining a kennel after revocation or during suspension of a license shall be punished by a fine of $250. But really, it's going to be the maximum allowable, correct?
I think that is the maximum allowable, but we'll check.
Wherever there's a dollar inserted here for fines, run it up. Max it out. Right? That's the feedback. Yep. Max it out to state law.
And for the record,
you're not trying to be a pain. If you run your kennel well,
right,
then you don't have to worry about it. If you're going to run your kennel poorly, then you're going to have to worry about it, and then you're going to have to pay the fine. So
for the record, I feel that way on every business. I don't feel that way strictly. I don't feel this way strictly on dog kennels. I feel that way universally in our businesses. If there are fines that are substantial, then if you're running your business the right way, then you know the warning at first should take care of it. If it doesn't, then you're going to have to.
Okay. Feed help to the fine. Anything else on kennels? We have some other stuff on the agenda, so I want to try and move this along.
Just one quick question: can we insert some provision for what happens for non-payment of fines? I mean, if they don't pay within a certain amount of time, their license is suspended? Or, I mean, what happens if they just sit on it?
Isn't that always the case? We can suspend the license if they don't pay the fine.
But is there a time frame in there?
No, there isn't. It's not mentioned.
So, Mr. Kamal, it's excellent feedback. If we could make sure that we can control license issuance or continuation based on prompt payment of fines, I think that's a reasonable business matter for the town to put in there.
Yeah, we will look into that, though I should point out, in the general town bylaw, there is already a section that addresses non-payment of fines.
Okay, yeah. Well, let's just, again, we want to be as firm and as clear as possible.
Articulate it.
Okay, that goes and finishes the draft warrant. I remember school committee, DPW, your DPW director, if we can find them, trustees of the school fund or whatever it is, and
appropriations
committee, school committee, obviously.
Planning board.
Was that it, Mr. Kamal, as far as visitors to specific questions?
Yes, as far as visitors is concerned, I think that covers everybody.
And what we'll do when we have those folks join us is we'll take things out of order and move through the ones that are visiting first. And then we'll come back to the others.
Yep.
Okay? Everybody good with the draft warrant? Still in draft form?
Yep.
We've got feedback to work on now, and they'll come back to us. Moving right along. So that really handles item C in your town manager's report agenda as well, which is draft kennel licensing bylaw changes.
Yep.
Why is that an action item for tonight?
Again, we were working from the perspective, if the board was satisfied with the bylaw issues, the board would have accepted the article as is and moved on.
But we want some changes. We want to firm some things up, so we'll table it till our regular meeting on warrant stuff, okay?
Yes.
All right, ballot questions. Town charter. Mr. Kamalo.
Yes, in your packet, I included the document that outlines the ballot questions already approved by the board, and the three additional ballot questions that the board needs to act upon tonight. The new ballot questions include setting the amount for the underwrite, the question for converting constables from elected to appointed, and the question for the town charter. We now have a precise description prepared by town council on the changes that are contained in the town charter revisions. And so basically we're asking the board to add those three questions to the original, is it four or five, that were approved by the board.
Sorry, I missed something there. I was checking something here. So you want us to consider adding these ballot questions for these specific topics to the ballot itself, correct?
Yes.
Okay, so let's take them one at a time. Town charter. Why are we adding the town charter to the ballot? I thought that was like kind of like a done deal.
Yeah, it's the that's the.
Did we have a special town meeting and say, yep?
Yeah, there was a special town meeting. Then it was sent to the state's attorney general office, got received its approval, and now this is the final step, where the townspeople vote on the changes.
Chair, I'll entertain a motion to add the town charter adoption to the ballot for May 2017 election.
So moved. Second.
Mr. Kamal, are you good with that motion?
Yes, please.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to add the town charter to the ballot. Any discussion? All those in favor? Aye. Any opposed? It's done. Constable, we have an article that we just went through, going from elected to appointed. It wasn't really covered in the town charter review process for various reasons. We have an article at town meeting, we'll vote there, and then we go to the ballot because we got to change it from appointed to elected. Any questions? Chair will entertain a motion to approve a ballot question for the May 2017 election cycle to address whether constables will be appointed or elected officials in the town of Hopkinton.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any discussion? All those in favor of adding it to the ballot questions?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. It's unanimous and so carries. Underride. Mr. Kamalo.
We're specifically looking for the amount previously discussed, I believe, and I sense from the board's comments tonight that the amount is $1.5 million.
Let's just take a second and kind of go through this real quick. Underride, meaning we lower the tax levy for the town of Hopkinton that they can go, the town, all of us elected, you know, professional teams can go access through the tax base. Right, so if the tax levy today is $52 million and it's somewhere in that range, and we lower it $1.5 million, the tax levy goes to $50.5 million that you can access. Okay, so you have excess levy now of $1.5 million. It doesn't go away; it's still there, and we can tax it someday in the future. But right now, we don't take that money that we could take because Prop 2.5 allows us to go up a certain amount every year. And we haven't done that a couple of times over the years, and so we're building up this excess levy. This creates some frustrating processes like we're going through this year. Okay? It's a discipline, but it creates some headaches. We're talking about a 3% tax impact this year. We're talking about a 3% tax impact, and we're not talking about an override because we have an excess levy, and we can do it, okay? Because we didn't do it before. We didn't take the money before. Now, the philosophy of myself and a couple of members at that time was, well, we're not leaving the money in the taxpayers' pockets today so that we can take it in the future, right? So then you do an underride to kind of create that discipline as the excess levy builds up. Mm-hmm. And I think this is going to be something we have to cycle through several times if we continue on this path. Someday it may catch up and really haunt us. But it's, in my opinion, this doesn't really tie our hands too much because we're going to have an excess levy. I think it was predicted to be budgeted to be about $3 million for the next fiscal year. And the number that Mr. Sestari, I recall saying, was $1.5 million. Mm-hmm. So that still leaves lots of excess levy in there. So we could go above 2.5 next year if we have to without having an override and creating all kinds of other frustrations for the town. The general citizenry creates frustrations for us trying to work through it. But it's not going to tie our hands and say we can't have it. There's no flexibility. Okay. That's what an underride does. It sounds really cool, and frankly, it's good politics. But it does create some frustration and aggravation that we have to understand.
It doesn't lower anybody's taxes, but it removes the threat, basically. As long as you let that build up, it's a threat that it's always hanging out there. Someday the selectmen could decide, to tax to the full amount that's been building up, and you'd get a huge tax impact.
That so one.
That it's like the sword of Damocles that's hanging over your head, and by reducing it with an underwrite, it limits the amount that we, the board, could at any point in the future.
So let's say the tax levy today is $52 million, but we have an excess levy of $1.5 million. So we've only collected $50.5 million. That's all we're going to collect. We could have collected 52. We left that other money in the pockets of the taxpayers. Mm-hmm. But we could still go get it.
Right.
Right?
And this way
so
we won't get as much.
This way we won't be able to go get as much because we're going to reset the levy down again. Okay? But it doesn't tie our hands a great deal, but it does create other work for us. And we're kind of going through that right now because there's perceptions about, well, we could go get more. Why don't we go get more? And then, you know, some of us argue for 2.5 or 3, or you guys are pushing 3, and it creates other dynamics, and that's kind of what I think is some of our frustration this year. Am I explaining this correctly in lay terms?
Yes, you are. The flip side to your comment is that should the town need these additional resources in the future, and the only way the town can access the additional monies beyond the levy ceiling that would have been established would be through an override. So in other words,
it's future. We're pushing some discipline here. We are, and we're making it a little harder for ourselves.
And I see he's asking permission. Anytime that we want to go over that 2.5%, we should ask our constituents for permission to do that. Now, we're going to have a little excess levy capacity still left in our budgets for the future. But if we're going to be going over 2.5% any year, you know, we should ask for permission. And this is $1.5 million is putting it back into the realm of not being able to be accessed by us. And I think people will appreciate us not being like this, that we, you know, if we go up by 3 or 4% this year, people are saying, well, wait a minute, shouldn't they have asked us over 2.5%? Well, they may not understand that since the last few years, we only went up 2% to 1.5%, but we banked all those fractions, and now we're giving those fractions back.
And those fractions that we banked
represent millions
are like annual annuities. They're always in that number. So it grows, not exponentially, but it grows at a higher rate than what you originally saved the taxpayers, because each year you could have gone and got that. So each year as time passes, there's a little bit bigger percentage that you could have grabbed. And that's why the excess levy is growing, even though we haven't, we've gone to 2.5 last couple of years, right? But the excess levy is still growing because that original savings from 4, 5, 6 years ago is gradually increasing.
In fact, numbers wise, I think the biggest contributor to the excess levy is the fact that the town has an established practice of approving the large scale projects as exempt. So in other words, approving the library, the DPW, the school, outside the 2.5 limit. That's why the levy keeps growing.
Which isn't, in my opinion anyway, isn't a bad thing, because we borrow money really cheap because we have a very high bond rating. Mm-hmm. One of the reasons we have a high bond rating is we have an excess levy.
Okay.
So it all kind of comes together. Some bond, I think, look at the levy and say, I'll go get the money. But others, I think, look at it and say there's flexibility there. It's like a savings account where you didn't take it from the taxpayers yet.
Mr. Chairman, on that idea, if we reduced our excess levy, would that negatively affect our ability if a bonding agency looks at us and sees that we don't have all that levy capacity?
I don't think so, because we got to AAA with about $1 million of excess levy. Is that correct? Somewhere in that range?
Yes.
And we're headed towards $3 million of excess levy. Okay, so with this 1.5, we're kind of cutting it in half, so we're bringing it back down a little bit. We still have
what I think was reasonable from the bonds.
I'm not the
bond guy.
Just don't want to disadvantage us.
Yeah. I just remember when we got the AAA rating; it was pretty cool.
Though I can share with the board and the community that in our prior conversations with our rating agencies, they have discouraged the use of the word underwriter because it takes away the soft reserve, it takes away the town's ability to deal with emergencies in the future. So in our conversations with the board and rating agencies, whilst, yes, the board has politically supported the underwrite concept, that concept may in the future come into play in our conversations with the rating agencies.
I think meeting halfway in the middle on the excess levy discussion and how we manage that excess levy, fine, we can talk about it like that. Meeting in the middle, I think, is financially reasonable. Okay, so the chair will entertain a motion to place an underwrite question on the ballot for the May 2017 election cycle.
So moved.
In the amount of $1.5 million.
Thank you.
Correct, Mr. Kamal?
Yes.
Does that clarify for you what you need then for the ballot question?
Yes, please.
The town council will draft the actual question, correct?
The question is already provided. All the board needed to do is to insert the amount.
Okay, so we have a motion before us at $1.5 million for the underwrite question. Is there a second?
Yes.
Sorry, who made the motion?
Claire made the motion.
Mrs. Wright, Mr. Catino second. Further discussion. There are people in Hopkinton that don't want to lower the excess levy. And that's understandable because they're concerned, they're confused. Maybe they're not confused. They have a different view that if we have tough times making budgets work, at the same time, why are we having a reduction in the excess levy? Why don't we just go get more money and take it? Because at the end of the day, it boils down to how much money do we take out of taxpayers' bank accounts to pay for this fiscal year and perhaps next fiscal year, setting up for next fiscal year. And my philosophy is we have the ability to deal with this year and next year, for that matter. We have flexibility, but let's leave what we can in their pockets until we need it. If we need it, we're going to have to come get it. But we're trying to get through this year at around three, is that the number we're talking about right now? And, you know, future years it might get tight too, but we still have flexibility. So while some think take it all, we don't need to take it all. And if we did, we would, but we don't need to. We're not in that state. Someday, hopefully that never happens, you know, we might have to go get some more. But I'd rather leave it in the taxpayers' pockets until the need is there.
And then ask for permission.
And then ask for,
you know, rather than, you know, if we have the excess levy capacity to go up 6% and not have to ask permission, I don't think that's fair to the taxpayers that all of a sudden, well, how did my taxes go up more than 2.5% without you asking me?
So,
and then
so
we'd have to have that discussion.
You would have that discussion, but technically you would not have to do it with an override.
Right, that's what I'm saying.
Right?
We'd just be able to,
we'd be able to go get it.
Go up to 6%, then people would just say that's just wrong.
They have to trust us now that we can lower the excess levy and leave money in their pockets. And they also have to trust us that maybe 3 years from now we got to go to 4%. Gosh, I hope not, but, you know, whatever, if something were to happen, they have to trust us then too. So it's just...
Yep.
It's a philosophy about taxation and where you leave money in reserve, really. Okay? All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, so we'll put a question on the ballot specific to a $1.5 million underwrite. Mr. Kamalo, anything else?
Again, for the record, therefore, these are the questions. The first one is, shall the town of Hopkinton approve the charter amendment proposed by town meeting pursuant to the vote taken under Article 1 of the January 30th, 2017 special town meeting, as summarized and described by town council in the memo shared with the board. Number two, shall the town of Hopkinton vote to have its elected constables become appointed constables of the town? And then number three, shall the town of Hopkinton be required to reduce the amount of real estate and personal property taxes to be assessed for the fiscal year beginning July 1st, 2017 by an amount equal to $1.5 million.
Reduce.
Yes.
What does that say there?
Reduce the amount of real estate and personal property taxes to be assessed for the fiscal year reduce, beginning okay. yep. July 1st, 2017 by an amount equal to $1.5 million.
Okay. Excellent. Everybody good?
Yep, good.
Anything else, Mr. Kamal?
More said.
Future board agenda items. Mr. Tedstone, Mr. Patino.
I'm good right now.
Mrs. Wright.
Yes, one thing that I had mentioned earlier, and it's particularly pertinent with the upcoming opening of Legacy Farms Road, I would like the board to, I think revisit's probably the wrong word, but have discussions about the naming or re-signing of the roadway that right now it's Legacy Farms North. We have removed the historic name of Franklin Road from Hopkinton's major roadway, and I understand that technically the end of Franklin Road was discontinued. It's been grassed over. There was a citizen last year at town meeting very upset over that because what he was upset about was the removal of the historic Franklin Road name. The Legacy Farms North Road now is technically a new road, but then it turns into Franklin, and those Franklin Road residents have legal documents assuring them that their road will not be changed. That will remain Franklin. But the way Franklin has been removed, the historic Franklin Road name has been removed from our major thoroughfare, is not consistent with the spirit of our historic asset naming policy. And I would like the board, because we are in charge of road names and signage, to explore ways, perhaps through joint signage or directional signage, that restores the presence of the name Franklin Road on our major, on our major thoroughfare. There are many roads in the Commonwealth that share names at certain points. I think that can be done, and I'd like to just discuss how we can get that done. There are a number of residents on Franklin Road that continue to be bothered by the fact that that historic name has been taken away.
Okay. Mr. Kamala, would town council be able to help us with that at all? Seems to me there's a legal question in there somewhere.
It could be as simple as, you know, via or to such and such by way of or via. But some, it could be a joint signage thing, but some way to get keep that name on 135 even as a secondary road. I just think we could find a creative way.
Okay. We'll review the matter with the town council, Member Claire Wright, as well as public safety.
I would think public safety, but maybe there's a way to look at town council to help us.
Or a historical sign of former Franklin Road or something.
Well, if you notice, the invitation for the Legacy Farms opening says on Franklin Road. It says Franklin Road at the junction of Franklin and the North, so it's the little piece from 135 that's no longer Franklin, but then it's Franklin, and then it's very confusing. So
let's do this. If we could get with town council, public safety, and then also share some ideas with Mrs. Wright, and then when you feel we're ready to have a discussion at the board, if we could get that in front of me for the agenda.
Neighbors are like...
Assuming it's between now and May sometime, that'd be good. Okay. Before we adjourn, do we have anything to sign tonight? Is there a lot to sign tonight? Okay. So I think we're going to do from now on is not adjourn until we sign everything. Because sometimes we lose people and then everyone calls and says, I got to go back and sign another thing. I'm like, well, we didn't do it very well. So anyway.
Some of us have to go to work.
I know.
You
so
sign first.
Tonight we don't have to sign much. So with that, the chair will entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Any discussion? All those in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Thank you. Have a good night.